So hello, hello, hello mga FIPers. So ito ngayon tayo for our review sa RFPT. Now take note, nung previous batch, ako managano sa kanilang review subject ng ARW na, ito ng ARW nila. So with that, itong obligations na discuss ko sa kanila before ng lockdown. So ngayon, gagawan ko siya ng bagong video or gagawan ko siya ng video kasi nga, hindi ko nagawan to ng video kasi nga, as I've said, na-discuss ko to before ng lockdown. Pero yung discussion for contracts, yung discussion for law and partnerships, yun, nagawan ko sila ng lecture video last previous year, so yung gagamitin natin after nito. Ayun, for the law and corporations, since nagkaroon ng amendments, and yung amendments na yun is very substantial, so I suggest na tingnan nyo yung in-depth lecture video, undergrad lecture video na ginawa ko from the previous semester. Ako rin kasi nagturo ng law on partnership, corporations, and cooperatives sa previous semester sa mga second year. So with that, ginawan ko rin yun ng mga lecture videos, yung law on partnership, yung corporation code natin, yung bago, and yung short discussion sa cooperative. So with that, yun, kompleto tayo ngayon sa sa RFPT discussion. So sa corporations, di natin gagawa ng short one kasi nga nagkaroon ng very substantial, very significant amendments. So with that, kailangan balikan niyo yung in-depth discussion nun kasi promise, iba yung amendments. Marami mga changes talaga na significant na if naalala niyo pa yung discussion sa law and corporations nung undergrad pa kayo, makikita niyo talaga yung difference. So with that, I suggest, suggestion ko lang naman na tingnan niyo yung in-depth discussion nun. So, and yun, nasabi natin, di ba? Law on obligation and contracts. Ito yung lecture videos for the review lecture video. And take note, this current semester, I'm also teaching the law on obligation and contracts sa mga undergrad, sa mga first years natin ngayon. So with that, meron din akong lecture videos for yung in-depth discussion, undergrad discussion ng law on obligation and contracts sa YouTube channel na to. So with that, kung gusto nyo lang, di ba? Pero madali naman itong obligation and contracts eh. Pero kung gusto nyo ng in-depth discussion, you can watch that. So yun, cover natin yun. Yung law on partnership, corporations, and cooperatives, as I have said, law on partnerships, meron akong in-depth lecture video, meron din akong review lecture video. Law on corporations, wala siyang review lecture video, pero meron siyang in-depth lecture video, and I suggest, ulitin ko lang, na kung gusto nyo, yun ang panoorin nyo. Why? Kasi nga, may mga significant changes na nangyari sa law on corporations na baka mawindang kayo kasi nga very significant yun. And meron rin tayong short lecture video for the tawag dito? For the anong tawag doon? For the law on cooperatives. So yung law on sales, madali lang naman yung kasi yung substantial nun, yung substantial discussion nun is nasa kasi contract sila naman sila, special contract siya, nominal contract siya. Then yung negotin, negligible na yan, negotin kapatid. Negligible na yan. Basically, obsolete na yan. Kahit nga sa par exam, tanggal na yan. So, don't expect na magiging, kahit nga yung previous batch, yung batch namin, nagtay kami ng CPA board exam, di ko na inaral ang negotin. Kaya, nakapasa pa rin ako sa RFPT. Kasi nga, it is very insignificant sa exams. Kahit nga sa current lang natin ngayon, yung negotin, basically, kung ginagamit na lang yan sa mga promissory notes na lang. Yan na lang dyan yung ginagamit. So, very insignificant yan. As you can observe sa new curriculum, di ba? Wala lang separate subject ang negotin. Loan obligation and contracts, meron pa. Loan partnership corporation cooperatives, meron pa. Ang sales, basically, meron pa. Sales agency. And if choice ng teacher, pwede niya ipasok yung discussion ng negotin in that part. Pero wala na, di ba? So with that, let's start with our lecture video for or review video for obligations. So napahaba ang intro natin na. Now what is an obligation? Ito. Sa mga lahat ng CPA graduates, di ba? O sa lahat mga accountancy graduates, wait lang. Sa mga accountancy graduates, yeah, accountancy graduate sa mga CPA, Article 1156 yan yung tatatak talaga sa atin, tatatak talaga sa isip natin. Sorry. Yan talaga yung quote or yung provision ng batas na tumatatak talaga sa atin. An obligation is a juridical necessity to give to do or not to do. An obligation is a juridical necessity to give to do or not to do. An obligation is a juridical necessity to give to do or not to do. Yan, di ba? Yan yung common ground. Basically, sa mga common ground ng mga accountancy graduates is yung kabisado nila yung obligation. Yung definition ng obligation. Kaya yung definition ng contract, di ba? Ano yung definition ng contract? A contract is a meeting of minds between two persons whereby one bounds itself with respect to the other to give something or to render some service. Yung mga familiarities sa ating mga common grounds ng mga accountancy graduate, yung mga definition yan ng law and obligation and contract. So ito, ang definition ng obligation. As you can see, an obligation that has a juridical necessity. What juridical necessity? To give, to do, or not to do. And this, since this is a review, ano, review lecture video, don't ask. Of course, ang gagawin lang natin dito is to review. And there is around 56, 57 slides in this PowerPoint presentation. Kaya nga, review lang to. Review lang to for obligation. Ngayon, anong requisites for a valid obligation? Una, dapat meron tayong active subject. Active subject, this is the creditor or obligee. Now, take note, active subject, creditor or obligee, this is the person that has the entitlement to demand the fulfillment of the obligation. This person or this, ano, this subject, siya yung may right. Ngayon, as you can, ito naman si passive, ano? Si passive subject, debtor, obligor, ano to siya, di ba? Si debtor, si obligor, siya yung may obligation, siya yung may duty sa fulfillment ng obligation. Now, take note, bakit active, bakit passive ang tawag? Kasi nga, active, bakit? Kasi siya yung may right to demand, eh. Di ba? Pwede niyang i-demand yan, yung fulfillment obligation, siya yung kikilos. Si passive subject, si debtor, obligor, wala siyang choice. Passive lang siya because siya yung may duty gawin. Kaya siya passive. Wala siyang choice basically. Because the obligation is him for to is for him to perform. Prestation, this is the subject matter of the obligation. What subject matter? Basically, sa obligation na yan, ano yung conduct na kailangan mong gawin? Obligation to give, obligation to do, or obligation not to do? The conduct required to fulfill the obligation. And lastly, efficient cause or vinculum juris, also known as juridical tie or legal tie. Now, this is the one that binds the parties in an obligation. And one of a good example of that is a contract. Because, di ba? Contract binds the parties to their agreement. So, yan, active subject, passive subject prestation, efficient cause or and vinculum juris, juridical or legal tie. So, yan yung mga requisites. Ngayon, ito yung kinds of obligation lang, as to sanctions, yung civil obligations, based on civil relationship, natural, based on the ano. Ito naman, kinds of obligation as to performance, positive or negative. Positive, yung may kailangan kang gawin. Negative, wala kang kailangan gawin. As to subject matter, real and personal. Sa real personal, this is the obligation to give. Personal, this is the obligation to do or not to do. Yeah? So, dito yan, no? Juridical necessity to give, yan yung real obligation. Juridical necessity to do or not to do, yan yung personal obligation. Ngayon, pag positive personal obligation yan, yan, obligation to do something yan. Kung negative personal obligation yan, that is an obligation not to do something. Yeah? Ganyan. Law, sources of obligation, law. Imposed by law, batas natin ang nag-provide. Meeting of minds between two persons whereby one bounds itself with respect to the other to give something or to render some service. Quasi-contract. So, basahin natin kasi. Pero basically, sa quasi-contract, meron tayong mnemonics dyan, di ba? Yung love. Lawful, unilateral, voluntary. Ba? Yung lawful, unilateral, voluntary act. That a juridical relation resulting from lawful, voluntary, unilateral act, or lawful, unilateral, para mnemonics lang ba? Acts by virtue of which the parties become bound to each other to the end that no one, ito yung basis niyan, that no one shall unjustly enrich themselves at the expense of another. Yan yung basis ng quasi-contract. It is a juridical relationship that arises from a lawful, voluntary, unilateral acts whereby the parties are bound. Yeah? Are bound to each other in order for them to properly ano happen na walang party will unjustly benefit himself at the expense of the other. And as you know, di ba, familiar ka sa negosyorum gestio and sa solution indebiti. Sa negosyorum gestio is the voluntary management of another's property without their consent, kung saan ang gagawin mo is to protect the property. Voluntary management of a property without the consent of the owner. Kung saan, basically ang gagawin mo is for the benefit of that property, for the benefit of that owner. For example, di ba, ano magandang example dito? Kotse mo, sa labas ng bahay, nasusunog. May iniwan ka kasi sa loob. Yun, nasunog yung kotse mo. Nasusunog. Kapitbahay mo, nakita, uy, nasusunog ang kotse ng kapitbahay ko. Kunin, kinuha niya yung fire extinguisher niya sa bahay. So, para patayin yung sunog sa kotse mo. And in doing so, nasugatan siya o na-injured siya. Pero napatay niya yung nangyayari, napigilan niya yung sunog na nangyayari sa kotse mo. So in that case, ano nangyari? There's a voluntary management, oh, pinotect ng kapitbahay mo yung kotse mo from being totally burned down. And in doing so, injured him. So there's a voluntary management of others' property. And as we have said, ano yung basis ng quasi-contract? That no one shall unjustly benefit or enrich themselves at the expense of another people. So in this case, yung kapitbahay mo na napagasto sa fire extinguisher na na-aksidente, na-injure, you now have the obligation to compensate that kapitbahay. Yung kanyang medical bills, yung kanyang pambayad, pambili ng bagong fire extinguisher. Because you unjustly enrich yourself when your kapitbahay protected your property. So in that case, sabi ng batas, no, bawal ganun. Bawal lang unjustly benefits. Dapat compensate mo siya para quits kayo. Yun si negosyorum gestio. Solution indebiti, it is basically receiving something without the right to receive it, di ba? Receiving something without the right to receive it. Like for example, yung due date ng utang ng kapitbahay mo sa'yo is next month pa, pero nagbayad na siya ngayon. Na wala ka pa mang right to receive that kasi next month pa man yung due date. So yung kapitbahay mo, pwede niyang bawiin yan sa'yo and wala kang choice but rather isauli yan. Because you don't have the right to receive that thing. So yun ang solution indebiti. So yun, mga recap-recap lang ng review sa ang na-discuss nyo sa ano, nung undergrad nyo for obligation. Now, dito punta tayo sa quasi-delic. Sa quasi-delic naman, basahin na natin, kasi hindi natin yung sato kabisado yung ano niya, yung, siyempre, batas yan eh. Provided to ng civil code, yung definition nila. So, alin natin yung kung anong sinabi ng civil code. So, ito. 2176. Quasi-delic is an act or omission by a person known as tortfeasor which caused damage to another in his person or property or rights giving rise to an obligation to pay for the damage done there being fault or negligence. So dito naman kay quasi-delic, you have caused damage to another person, to his property or to his right. And yung pag-cause mo ng damages is because of a fault or negligence on your part. Yeah? Fault or negligence on your part. Kasalanan mo basically. So in that case, since you have caused damage to another person, you have now the obligation to compensate that, to indemnify that person. That is quasi-delic. And the requisites of quasi-delic, ano? There must be an act or omission. Second, may fault or negligence. Third, there must be damage cause. Of course, damage eh. Tsaka ka lang man magbabayad kung may na-damage cause ka. Pero pag wala kang damage na na-cause, wala kang kailangan bayaran. But take note, meron tayong different kinds of damages that for ano na kailangan indemnify, which later on sa slides pa yon. So hindi lang automatic na physical damages, no, meron may mga damage to your right, mental damages basically. Pangapat na requisites, there must be a direct relation or connection of cause and effect between the act or omission and the damage. So basically yung ginawa mong ano act or omission, yun yung nag-cause ng damage. Ganun lang kasi. Panglima, there is no pre-existing contractual relationship between the parties. Kasi if there's a pre-existing contractual relationship, then that is basically contravention of tenor. So dapat, walang pre-existing contractual relationship. Kasi in that case, mapupunta yan sa contract eh. So dapat, no pre-existing. Same sa quasi-contract, no pre-existing. Kaya quasi eh, semi, tawag yan, semi. And lastly, yung last source of obligation acts or omission punishable by law or basically the crime. Yun dyan nangyari. But in reality class, itong sources of obligation, dalawa lang yan eh. Mm-mm. Bakit? Kasi itong si quasi contract, provided yan ng batas, civil code. Quasi delict, provided din yan. Torts, acts or omission punishable by law, revised penal code and other special penal laws. Special penal laws. Kung makikita nyo, laws rin to siya. So in reality, dalawa lang talaga ang source of obligation. Si law and si contract. Kasi itong quasi-contract, quasi-delict, and itong crime, acts or omission punishable by law, lahat yan sila nang galing sa batas. So dalawa lang talaga yung totoong source. But for purposes of ano, lima. So to nature and effect of obligation, specific or determinating is one which, ito familiar man kayo dito, is one which is ano, particularly designated or physically segregated from others of the same kind. Yeah? Of others of the same kind. Alam niyo man to, yung specific determinating. For example, itong cellphone. Sabi natin itong cellphone lang. Di ba? Yun ang sinabi, itong cellphone. Ano siya? Basahin mo natin dito sa baba pala. Ang sana naman, indeterminate or generic thing is one which is not particularly designated or physically segregated from all others of the same class. So, di ba? Na-discuss naman ito, pero recap lang ito, di ba? Pag specific or determinating, sabi natin itong cellphone lang. Itong cellphone lang. You can say that is an indeterminate or generic thing. Kasi nga, not particularly designated. Sabi nga, ang cellphone, Poco M3 cellphone. Yun lang. Pero pag sinabing, yung Poco M3 cellphone na pagmamayari ni sir, o yung Poco M3 cellphone na may serial number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 9, 10, yun, specific or determinate na siya. So depende yan sa kung papaano siya present. So kung generic lang, yun, belong to a group, yun yan, so generic siya. Pero pag specific siya, cellphone ni sir, Poco M3 cellphone ni sir, or this device with a serial number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or this device that belongs to him, specific or determinate. Now, it is very important to know if the object, if the thing is specific or generic. Bakit? Kasi iba yung application ng law sa kanilang dalawa. Iba para sa specific thing, iba para sa generic thing. O, sanin? Kasi ito, duties or debtor in obligation to give a determinating. Di ba sabi natin? Dapat importante, ulitin lang natin, importante yung na malaman kung specific siya or generic siya because the application of law is different sa kanilang dalawa. Ito, duties of debtor in obligation to give a determinate thing. Preserve the thing. Yeah? Preserve, anong sabi? Kung if the problem is silent or the contract is silent, the agreement is silent, diligence of a good father pa family, di ba? Yung protection mo sa thing. Preserve the thing, deliver the fruits of the thing, deliver the accessions and accessories. Ito lang na ito. Recap na lang. Deliver the thing itself and answer for damages in case of breach. Ito naman yung duties ni debtor kapag yung obligation niya is to give a generic thing. Simple lang. Yeah? To deliver the thing of which of the quality intended. And basically, ang usapan dyan, yung sa gitna lang. Not so much, not low quality, not how high quality, but rather in between them. Yan yung sa quality pinag-usapan. And to be liable in case of breach, as you can see here, yeah, mas protected si specific thing kaysa kay generic thing. Bakit? Kasi yung specific thing class, hindi na yan mapapalitan. Yung generic thing, madali lang yan palitan because kuha ka lang, replace lang from the others of the same class. Kung sinabi na 1 kilo of sinandoming rice, na wala mo yung 1 kilo na sinandoming rice na dapat i-deliver mo, makakakuha ka pa rin ng 1 kilo ng sinandoming rice because of the same class siya. Generic yung designation nyo sa thing na yun. And these are the remedies of the creditor in a real obligation if the debtor fails. And as we have said, ano yung real obligation? This is the obligation to give something, to deliver something. So in that case, remedy si creditor if the debtor fails to perform the real obligation. specific pag ano, specific or determinate, as you have said, iba yung application ng law pag specific or determinate. Pag specific or determinate, demand a specific performance. Kasi nga that is specific thing eh. Nag-iisa lang yan ang bagay na yan. So kailangan, yun ang gusto ma-receive ni the creditor, demand that thing. Second, demand for rescission with damages. And kapag wala ka nang pwedeng gawin, yeah, damages na lang. Take note, these are mutually exclusive. Meaning, isa lang yung pwede mong ano, piliin. Tama ba? Pero if example, hindi na available yung specific performance, edi decision na lang. Kung hindi sila available, damages na lang. If example, di ba? Sira yung diniliver niya sa'yo or may defect but not so significant na magagamit mo pa rin yung diniliver, yung thing, so damages na lang to compensate for that ano, defect. Di ba? Mga ganong klaseng bagay. Ngayon, ito naman pag generic or indeterminate thing. As for compliance at debtor's expense with damages or damages only. Bakit? As for compliance lang. Bakit? Kasi nga, pwede ka makahanap ng iba. Oo, parang ano lang yan, shota mo. Hindi lang yan nag-iisa, makakahanap ka pa ng iba dyan. Hindi yan sa specific. Oo, generic yan. Charot. Diba? Kaya pwede ka pa maghanap ng iba, pero at the debtor's expense na. With damages. O, kasi nga, hindi lang siya ang pwedeng magbigay niyan sa'yo. Pwede lang ibigay siya ng ibang tao. So, hindi yan specific or determinate thing. O, kaya nga, as for compliance at debtor's expense with damages, pwede ka magpunta sa ibang seller para sila yung mag-provide sa'yo ng thing na yon at the debtor's expense with damages or, in this case, or another is damages only. Because that is a generic thing. Pwede mo yung makuha sa ibang bagay. Hindi lang yan yung magbibigay sa inyo. So, ngayon, ito. What if the debtor fails in a personal obligation to do? Ito, to do. Di ba? Personal obligation to do. Debtor fails to perform an obligation to do. Ito yung mga instances kung saan the debtor fails in a personal obligation to do. Ito yung mga instances. Una, the debtor fails to perform an obligation to do. Ibig sabihin, hindi niya na-perform yung kailangan niyang i-perform. Hindi niya, di ba? Sabi mo, ayusin niyo yung ano, CR niyo. Pero, kinuntata mo, ayusin yung services niya para ayusin yung CR niyo. Pero hindi niya naayos. Perform, failure to perform that. Pangalawa, debtor performs an obligation to do, but contrary to the terms thereof. Ang sabi niyo, ayusin, ang usapan nyo, ayusin nyo yung CR nyo. Na kung saan, ang usapan, ito yung brand na ipampapalit niya doon sa nasira sa CR nyo. However, ibang brand, generic brand, low quality brand, ibang brand yung ano, ano ba magandang ano, CR? Yung bowl, di ba? Ano mga brand ng CR? Carrier ba? Kalimutan ko ng mga brand ng bowl eh. Pero sabi to, brand B yung pinag-usapan nyo na ipapalit sa bowl sa CR nyo. Pero ang binili niya is brand C. Na that is a contrary to the terms thereof. Kasi ibang usapan nyo sa brand na ipapalit niya, na i-install niya. So yan, no? Failure on the part of the debtor. Pangatlo, debtor performs an obligation to do but in a poor manner. Ayusin nyo yung CR nyo. Naayos niya nga pero ang pangit ang pagkaayos. Diba? So that is a failure. Ito naman, pag an obligation not to do. Di ba? Personal negative obligation. Ginawa niya yung hindi niya dapat gawin. Ang sabi mo, huwag kanyang mahalin, pero minahal ka niya. Oo, charot eh. Pero, on a serious note, sabi mo, huwag gagamitin yung sasakyan kasi inaayos pa. So, usapan niya yun. Pero ginamit niya. So, ginawa niya yung personal negative obligation na hindi niya dapat gawin at the first place. So, in that case, nagkaroon ng failure performance on the part of the debtor. Anong pwedeng gawin ni creditor? Anong remedies niya? If debtor fails to comply, yung first part of failure to perform, generally, to have the obligation performed by himself or other peeps at the debtor's expense. Sir, bakit to have the obligation performed by himself or other peeps at the debtor's expense? Hindi mo siya pwedeng utusan, sir, na gawin niya talaga, mag-demand ka sa kanya na gawin niya yung obligation? Hindi, class. Kasi sabi ng constitution natin, involuntary servitude is prohibited. Hindi mo pwedeng pilitin ang isang taong gawin ang ayaw niya. Hindi mo pwedeng pilitin ang isang tao na gawin yung ayaw niya. Bakit? Because that will constitute an involuntary servitude. Bawal yan, sabi ng constitution. You're making someone your slave, basically. So, bawal yan. So, kaya ang sabi ng batas natin, generally, at the debtor's expense, because kasalanan niya naman, di ba? To have the obligation to perform by himself. Si creditor na mismo gagawa kung kaya niya. Or mag-hire siya ng ibang tao para sila na lang gumawa ng performance na yun. Of course, at the debtor's expense. However, may exception tayo. Personal consideration. What do you mean, sir? For example, anong sinong artista ba? Si Sara Heronimo, yun sabi ni Sara Heronimo. Si Sara G. Kaya mo siya hinar na kumanta at the first place because she is Sara G. That is your personal consideration. Yes, singing can be done by other people. But the personal consideration why you hired that person is because that person is Sara Heronimo himself. Ngayon, if Sara Heronimo himself cannot perform or fails to perform the obligation to sing, hindi mo pwedeng, you cannot do perform yourself or other peeps. Hindi mo pwedeng gawin yan. Because the personal consideration, bakit may kakanta is because that is Sara Heronimo. So in that case, recover damages na lang. Oo. So, di ba? If you can perform himself, if that credit, okay, so ganito yung dalawang pwede mong gawin. To have the obligation to perform by himself or other peeps at the debtor's expense, and to recover damages. Pwede mo yan. Pag-perform mo sa iba, recover ka damages from gano. Pero, when personal considerations are involved, like for example, yung kay Sara Heronimo, ang pwede mo lang gawin is to recover damages because you cannot, as you have said, involuntary servitude is prohibited by the Constitution. So you cannot compel Sara Heronimo to perform because that will constitute an involuntary servitude. So yun, ang magagawa mo lang in that case is to recover damages. Ngayon, sa instances of ano, contrary of terms and poor manner, habit and done at the debtor's expense or and damages. Dito tayo sa ano? Personal negative obligation. What if ginawa ni debtor yung hindi mo pinapagawa sa kanya? No, matigas ulo. So, to have it undone at debtor's expense and damages only. Kasi, bakit ito maybe only? Kasi may mga instances na hindi na pwedeng bawiin kung ano ang nagawa na. Oh, hindi mo na pwedeng bawiin. Hindi mo na pwedeng mabago pa. Pass is pass. So in that case, kapag hindi na pwedeng maandan, nasaktan ka na, damages na lang yung pwede mong singilin. Pero pag pwede pang iandan, yeah, andan and damages. Pero pag hindi na, damages na lang. So ito, talking about damages, anong mga kinds of damages tayo meron? Una, si actual or compensatory. Simply, make good or replace the loss caused by the wrong. So, kung magkano yung actual na nawala, di ba? For example, nasira niya yung kotse mo. So, kung magkano yung actual na value ng kotse mo na nasira niya, yun yung babayaran. Yun yung i-compensate, yun yung indemnify. Simple lang yung si actual. Madali yan siyang i-determine. Kung ano yung nasira, ano yung nawala, ano yung na-damage, yun yung babayaran. Pagdating kay moral, ito sila. Pagdating ito kay moral, nominal temperate, exemplary, ito determination by the court na to. Oh, this court ito ang magde-decide kung magkano yung damages. Itong actual, oh, as I have said, kung magkano yung actual na nasira, oh, di ba? Yun yung i-compensate sa iyo. Kung magkano yung na-damage, yun yung i-compensate sa iyo. Kung ang damage sa sakyan mo, nasira ng ibang tao is 100,000 pesos, then yun yung actual damages. Dito kay liquidated, kung anong agreement ng parties, yeah, yun yung ano, yun yung babayaran, yun yung indemnify. So itong pagdating kay actual and ano, liquidated, diretso yan kung ano yung amount of damages. Pero pagdating kay moral, pagdating kay nominal, temperate and exemplary, korte ang magdi-decide yan because depende sa facts and circumstances ng case, yung pag-grant ng damages. So itong moral, di ba? To alleviate moral suffering, nominal to vindicate a right that was damaged. Ito ang mga nominal damages to. Since it relates to vindicate a right, provide sa civil code, 2100 plus ata yun, article 25. Oh, may lista yan doon kung ano yung mga ano. Ano yung mga right na pwedeng bayaran ng nominal damages. Temperate naman, itong kay temperate, yung hindi kayo sure magkano yung loss. So, hindi kayo sure eh. So yung judge mag so yung magka-calculate based on the ano, based on the facts and circumstances of the case. Exemplary or corrective intended to serve as a deterrent to serious wrongdoings, ha? Pang deterrent, pang prevent, di ba? O sabi natin, oh, mahirap pala gawin yan eh. Kasi ang exemplary damages, 100,000, oh, yeah, mga ganun. Pang panakot ba, basically. So yan ha. So take note, actual and liquidated, determine na yan. Madali yan si determine. Magkano yung actual loss, magkano yung actual nasira, magkano yung actual damages, yun yung bayaran. Liquidated, kung ang agreed ng parties, yun yung babayaran. Moral, nominal, temperate, exemplary, depende yan sa determination ng facts and circumstances, depende yan sa kung ano yung ibibigay na amount ng korte. Ito naman, ano yung mga grounds kung saan magbabayad ka ng damages, na mapaparequire ka magbayad ng damages. Fraud. Ang i-discuss dito, fraud, negligence, and delay, kasi obviously, ang contravention of tenor is, hindi mo ginawa kung ano yung kailangan mong gawin sa ano. Hindi mo ginawa, or kung ano yung agreement mo, nag-deviate ka from that agreement. So, contravention of tenor. So, ang discuss natin ito is, fraud, negligence, and delay. Ako cover talaga ng ano. So, ang fraud, yeah, I'm so fraud of chara. Deliberate or intentional evasion by the debtor of normal compliance, huh? Normal compliance of his obligation, that is fraud. That is fraud. And take note, the thing about fraud kasi, that separates it from negligence, is that fraud is intentional. That is the problem with that. There's malice on your part. That is why, that is ano, that is punishable by law. Crime yan. Deliberate or intentional evasion kasi yan eh. Sinadya mo, may malice on your part. So with that, dalawang classification tayo meron. Fraud in obtaining consent and fraud in the performance of the obligation. Causal fraud or dolo causante. Kung saan, basically itong causal fraud, without such fraud being committed, the consent will not be given. The consent will not be obtained. Oh, ito yung reason, yung commission ng fraud, yung reason bakit you were able to obtain the consent. That is the causal fraud, dolo causante. On the other hand, incidental fraud or dolo incidente, with or without such fraud, you will still be able to obtain the consent. Oo. Anong ayun ah. Sa causal fraud, yan yung reason bakit na-obtain mo yung consent. Sa incidental fraud, whether or not it exists, you will still be able to obtain the consent. And pagdating sa causal fraud, it is voidable. And as you have said, voidable contracts are valid until they are annulled. Incidental fraud, ano to? Valid, but you will still be entitled to damages. Oh. So valid siya. Hindi mo yung pwede void. Hindi mo pwede voidable yan. Hindi mo pwede i-annul yan. That is considered to be valid. Pero, entitled to damages ka pa rin. So voidable, di ba? Annul mo na siya, pwede ka na mag-annul ng damages because may fraud eh. Liability for damages yan. Pero main different factor nila kasi is yung consent. Kung kinomit mo yung fraud, and dahil sa fraud na yun, nakuha mo yung consent, causal, dolo causante. On the other hand, whether or not kinomit mo yung fraud, the consent will still be given, dolo insidente. And yung second classification is fraud in the performance of the obligation. No, niloko mo. Ang usapan nyo, bibigyan mo siya, i-deliver mo siya ng 50 sacks of sinandoming rice or jasmine rice. Pero ang binigay mo, NFA. Eh, sinadya mong ibigay. Kasi gusto mong makatipid, niloko mo. Fraud in the performance of the obligation. Oo, nang goyo ka basically. Ngayon, take note, waiver of past frauds, carry bells. Allowable yan. Kasi basically, ang nangyari dyan, pinatawad mo. Pero waiver of future fraud, bawal yan. Bakit? Kasi, pag i-waive yung future fraud, isipin ng taong naka-benefit dyan is, uy, so kaya ako mag-commit ako ng future fraud, okay lang. Kasi nag-waive siya eh. Kalokohan yun. You will basically incentivize the commission of fraud. So, bawal yun. Waiver, pero waiver past fraud, pwede. Kasi basically, nangyari dyan, pinatawad mo yung nagkasala sa'yo. Negligence. As you have said, negligence is lesser than fraud. Because fraud is intentional. Negligence, not intentional. Sadyang, there's ano, lackluster on your part na hindi mo maayos ginawa yung dapat mong gawin. The omission of the diligence which is required by the nature of the obligation and corresponds with the circumstances of the person, time, and place. You did not properly did what you are supposed to do. Yeah? Driver ka ng public utility vehicles. With that, you have a higher degree of responsibility considering that is a PUV. But, you committed negligence. Sinayaan mong hindi proper yung hindi mo proper ginawa trabaho mo. Damages. Kinds of negligence. Contractual negligence or those negligence that was performed in the, ano, or that was committed in the performance of the contract. Tort, quasi-delic, culpa contractual, civil negligence or culpa alkiliana. Yung pinag-usapan natin sa quasi-delic. Yeah, quasi-delic. And culpa criminal when it comes to crime. Ngayon punta tayo sa delay or sa default or default. Default to. May T yan. Default or mora. Sa delay, basically, non-fulfillment of an obligation with respect to time. Kaya delay, di ba? With respect to time. Non-fulfillment of an obligation with respect to time. Ang sabi, April 15, gawin mo na tong obligation na to. If dumating ng April 15, automatic ba? No, delay na. Depende. Pero later on yan. Kinds of delay, mora solvendi, delay of debtor, mora accipiendi, delay on the part of the creditor and compensa sumere, silang dalawa ang may delay. Ngayon, take note of this. Let's look at the requisites para makonsider na may delay. Debtor does not perform an obligation when it is due. Creditor demands performance. Ayun. Debtor fails to adhere to such demand. In that case, kompleto ang requisites, may delay. Take note of the general rule when it comes to delay. No demand, no delay. No demand, no delay. No demand, no delay. Kaya kailangan na mahalagang demand. O, kaya sinabi natin kanina, April 15 yung due. Automatic ba delay? Depende. Kasi debtor does not perform the obligation when it's due. Diba? Usapan nyo, April 15, i-deliver sa yung kalabaw. April 15, wala pa na deliver. Automatic bang delay? Depende. Depende kasi meron tayong exception sa general rule na no demand, no delay. So, example, silent. April 15 ang usapan, hindi nabigay. Okay, creditor demands performance. Debtor, after hearing the demand, after being notified of the demand, fails to perform. Still, there's a delay. Pero take note, yung no demand, no delay, na general rule, kaya nga general rule, di ba? As you have said, general rule always pertains or always tells us that there's an exception. Kasi hindi ang sasabihin na general rule kung walang exceptions. Ito yung exceptions to the general rule of no demand, no delay. When the law so provides, pag sinabi ng batas na ganitong araw, ano, ganun mo ibigay, dyan mo i-perform. For example, ano, batas, payment of taxes. April 15 sinabi ng batas, April 15 mo gawin. Yeah? Kasi the law provides that. Another, when the obligation expressly declares, kaya sabi natin kanina yung delivery of kalabaw of on April 15. Kapag hindi sinabi sa obligation na automatic delay, o kailangan pa rin ng demand ni creditor. Pero pag explicitly, oh, sinabi stipulated sa obligation na non-performance of the obligation on the due date of April 15 will result to a delay on the part of the debtor, then that is an obligation expressly declaring that there's a delay. So, depende. Kung silent ang ano, obligation, wala sa sinabi, sinabi lang yung due date. Ngayon ito, when time is of the essence. Ano meaning yan? Ang usapan, yeah? Ang usapan, i-deliver mo yung birthday cake on January 1. Diba? Usapan, i-deliver mo yung birthday cake on January 1. Eh kaso, hindi mo nagawa yung obligation na yun. And there's no demand on the part of the creditor. Ngayon, kakasuhan ka na for damages. Ngayon, pwede mo bang sabihin sa judge, eh judge, wala nga siya nag-demand ng cake eh. Bakit? Walang delay on my part, di ba? Di ba judge? No demand, no delay tayo judge. Sabi ng judge, loko, may exception tayo sa general rule. Ano yun? When time of is of the essence. Alam mo na nga, pang birthday yan eh. Birthday cake nga ang sabi. Bakit hindi mo diniliver on the date of the birthday? Eh, tanga ka pala. Diba? Hindi mo pwedeng gawing excuse yan, no demand, no delay. Kasi time is of the essence. Ang sabi, birthday cake, i-deliver January 1 for a birthday. Diba? Time is of the essence. Pangapat, when demand would be useless. Bakit magiging useless? Such as when the determinating to be delivered na destroy na. Oh, ba't ka pa mag-demand? Sira na ngayong ano eh. Determinating. But take note, emphasis sa determinating because that is specific, di ba? Hindi yan replaceable. Pag generic yan, replaceable yan. Pwede ka makahanap sa iba. So take note, emphasis sa determinating. Or when said determinating, ito determinating ulit, is delivered to another person, then there's already delay when without demand. Bakit? Kasi in both of these cases, what can you see? What can you see? In both of these cases, there's a fault on the part of the debtor. Oh, determinating to be delivered, destroyed at the debtor's fault. Kasalanan ng debtor eh. So since kasalanan niya, nasira eh. Kasalanan niya nasira. Wala siyang karapatan. Na maghinta- wala siyang karapatan gamitin yung general rule na don't, no demand, no delay. Because he's at fault. Siya yung reason bakit nasira. Another one, when said determinating is delivered to another person. Alam mo nang pinamis mo sa ibang tao, i-deliver mo to another person. That's double sale. Kasalanan niya ni debtor. So he's at fault again. And since he's at fault again, he has no right to compel the defense of no demand, no delay because in this case, he's at fault. So in that case, demand would be useless kasi kasalanan ni debtor. Yun. And lastly, in reciprocal obligations, ibig sabihin bilateral, palit-palit sila, yeah? The moment one of the parties fulfills his obligation, delay by the other begins even without demand. Kasi pinaform na ng iba eh. So, kailangan mo ni-perform yun sa'yo. Unless, iba yung usapan nyo. Kasi, as you have said, agreement of the parties yan. Effects of delay, the debtor is liable for damages. And if the thing is determined, the debtor is responsible for any fortuitous event. O, ito yung ano dito. Kasi ang usapan sa fortuitous event, it extinguishes the obligation. General rule din yun. It extinguishes the obligation. However, kapag meron ng delay before nangyari yung fortuitous event, mahalaga yan. Kapag nauna yung delay kaysa sa fortuitous event, the debtor is still liable. The debtor is still responsible. Pero kapag nauna yung fortuitous event, unang nangyari, okay, goods na. Pero kapag nauna yung delay compared sa fortuitous event, kasalanan ni debtor. So let's go to fortuitous event. Said event cannot be foreseen. Said event, definition niya. Cannot be foreseen, cannot be avoided, or cannot be foreseen. Said event cannot be avoided or evaded. And kahit na foreseeable siya, said event cannot be evaded. Ano example yan? Bagyo. Nasabi nyo na na may darating na bagyo. Yeah? Foreseeable. Sabi ni Pag-asa, may bagyong dadaan sa inyo. Eh, since yan ka, wala kang choice. Alangan i-move mo yung lupa. Alangan tatakbo yung Pilipinas papalayo ng bagyo. Ano yung going bulilit joke? Hindi. It cannot be evaded. So yung mga instances. Ngayon, anong requisites para maging valid yung 42's event to? Na maging valid excuse siya para ma-extinguish yung obligation? Depende. The cause is independent of debtor's will. Yan. Alangan, dapat walang kinalaman dyan si debtor. Yeah? The event is impossible to foreseen or if foreseeable man siya, inevitable. Hindi mo pwedeng mapigilan, hindi mo pwedeng ma-evade, hindi mo pwedeng maiwasan. And the occurrence of such event must render the impossibility of the debtor to comply with the obligation in a normal manner. Ba? Para maging valid yung 42's event to extinguish the obligation. However, that is only the general rule, kapatid. No person shall be liable for the happening of a 42's event. General rule. And as we have said, general rule always provides for an exception. That is its nature. The obligation shall be extinguished. However, the following are the exceptions. When the law says so, gaya ng ano, when obligor promised to deliver the same thing to two or more persons. Kasi as we can see here, yeah, there's fault on the part of the debtor na yung the same thing, yung specific determining, pinamiso sa dalawang taong ibibenta niya sa kanila. Paano yun eh? Nag-iisa lang yan. So, there's a fault on the part of the debtor. Gusto niya man goyo eh. Gusto niya man loko. So, sabi ng batas, oh, bawal yan kapatid. You're still liable. Kasi pinamis mo sa dalawang tao yan. Kung sa isang tao lang ka naging loyal, okay, maging excusable yan, 42-7. Pero sa dalawang tao ang pinamis eh, wala kang choice. When the party says so, gaya na sabi, usapan nila, stipulation ng contract, kahit na may 42-7, liable pa rin, agreement ang parties yan. And when the nature of the obligation requires assumption of risk, best example, insurance. Yeah? To prove that the loss was due to 42-7, the obligor must prove that no negligence or misconduct occasioned the loss. Kasi the burden of proof is with the obligor. Na kailan niya patunayan na, uy, 42-7 talaga yung naging reason bakit na-extinguish yung obligation, bakit hindi ko na-perform yan. The obligor, sana yung may ano, burden of proof niya, kailan niya patunayan na wala talaga siyang kasalanan. Oo, that no negligence or misconduct, ginawa niya talaga lahat. He performed due diligence para lang ma-secure performance of obligation. Ang problema lang, minalas lang eh. Nagkaroon ng 42-7. Kaya hindi niya na-perform. Kaya kailangan niya i-depend ni debtor para ma-extinguish yung kanyang obligation. Mm-hmm. Okay, now let's go to presumptions. So, mga presumptions lang ni meron under the topic of obligation when it comes to payment or receipt of the principal. So, let's read. So, additional note lang to eh. The receipt of principal without reservation as to interest, meaning hindi na-state, di ba? Hindi sinabi na may hindi pabayad yung interest. In that case, it shall give rise to the presumption that the interest was already paid. The receipt, bakit anong logic yan, sir? Kasi class, ang interest kasi, mas mataas yung kanyang degree of burden as compared sa payment of the principal. Kasi yung non-payment of the interest, kasi alam natin yung interest eh. Hanggat hindi mo nababayaran yung ano eh, pataas siya ng pataas. Yeah? Padami, palaki ng palaki yung amount. So ang sabi, in that case, kapag nagkaroon ng bayaran, without stating na that is a payment for interest or that is a reservation as to interest, yeah? The receipt of principal, so the receipt of the principal without reservation of the interest. Meaning, hindi sinabi na bayad na yung interest. Hindi sinabi na hindi pa bayad yung interest. Well, without reservation eh. Ang assumption is bayad na ang interest. Because, mas mataas yung degree of burden when it comes to interest because of the reason that the interest, yeah, it aggregates, it accumulates habang patagal. So kaya mas maganda na yan yung unang binabayaran because of the degree of the burden na meron dyan. So, yun yung presumption yan. On the other hand, dito tayo sa second sentence. The receipt of later installment without reservation as to the payment of the prior installment, it shall give rise to the presumption na yung prior installment, bayad na. Bakit kasi? Anong logic yan? Obviously, kasi, yeah, installment 1, 2, 3, 4, nagbayad ka ng installment 4 without reservation as to stating kung hindi pa bayad. Oh, yung installment 1, 2, 3. Ang assumption dyan, bakit ka magbabayad ng installment 4? Eh, alam mong hindi pabayad yung first 3 installment. Yeah? Presumption yun. Yeah? Kasi magbabayad ng installment 4, eh, meron pang installment 1, 2, 3. Diba? Kaya ang assumption, in that case, without prior reservation to the prior installment, diba? Bayad na sila. But take note, itong mga presumptions na to, they are disputable. Oh, they're not absolute. Rebuttable yan sila. Pwede mong ikontra yan. Na, uy, hindi pa nga bayad yung interest eh. Yeah? Uy, hindi pa bayad yung first 3 installment eh. Yeah? Pwede mong i-dispute yan. Because these are only presumptions. Now, let's go to this one. Remedies of creditor to enforce payment of his claims against debtor. So, basically, anong nangyari dito? This is done by the creditor in order to protect his right. Ito yung ginagawa niya. Ito, example, di ba? Si debtor, may obligation kay creditor na pagbayad ng 1 million peso, yan yung obligation. Simplihan natin. Yan yung obligation, currently existing. So, ito yung mga pwedeng gawin ni creditor para ma-enforce niya yung payment of his claim against debtor in order to protect his right. Una, pursue the property in possession of the debtor except those exempted by law. Anong meaning yan? Like, so for example, hindi nabayaran ni D. Hindi nabayaran ni debtor yung utang niyang 1 million pesos. So, pwede nga habulin ni creditor yung mga properties ni debtor para yun yung gawin na pang-compensate sa utang, pang-bayad sa utang niya. Yung kotse niya, di ba? Pero may mga properties na exempted by law. For example, family home. Family home, generally, exempted yan by law for the payment of ano. Hindi yan pwede habulin generally. Pero may mga exemptions siyang provided by us. Pero family home, generally, hindi yan pwedeng habulin pambayad ng utang. Pero may mga certain instances, apat ata yun, na pwede siyang ano, pwede siyang habulin. Pero yun yung exemption by law yun. So yun na. Pag hindi nagbayad si debtor, pwede mong habulin properties niya with some exemptions provided by law. Second, exercise all rights and being actions of the debtor except those personal to him. Action subrogatoria. Anong meaning yan? For example, si debtor, ayaw niya magbayad ng utang niya kay creditor. Oo, alam niya hindi mababayaran yung 1 million peso. And with that in hand, with that said, ayaw niyang matransfer yung possession ng properties niya kay creditor bilang pambayad ng utang niya. Ayaw yung mapunta. Oo, so he wants to defraud the creditor. He wants to defraud. Baliktad. Sa number 3 pala yun. Dito muna tayo sa number 2. Exercise all rights and bring actions for it except those personal to him. Tag dito. For example, di ba? Si debtor, ito, ulit natin, recap. Reverse tayo. Rewind. Si debtor, dito sa number 2 at the second bullet point. Si debtor, hindi makabayad ng, hindi niya mabayaran yung utang na 1 million peso. But take note, this is a fact or circumstance of the case. Merong isang tao, si letter A, may utang kay debtor of 1.5 million peso. Utang niya kay debtor. Itong si A, may utang kay debtor of 1.5 million. Now, in this case, may right of receivable si debtor from A. So, itong si letter C, or letter C, itong si creditor, exercise all rights and bring actions of the debtor, except those personal to him. Pwede niyang mag-file siya ng petition sa court na, instead na bayaran ni A yung 1.5 million peso kay debtor, yung 1 million portion dyan, idiretso na lang kay C. Pwede yung gawin ni C, file siya ng petition sa korte, action subrogatoria, na yung rights ni creditor over that 1.5 million, yung 1 million, mapupunta kay letter C, mapupunta kay creditor as payment of the debtor's 1 million debt kay sa kanya. Okay, action subrogatoria, subrogate, substitute. On the other hand, ito, sa number 3 tayo. Impugn the acts which the creditor may have done to defraud the creditor. Yung example natin na-rewind. Diba? Si debtor, may utang na 1 million pesos si creditor. Then wala siyang cash . So, since wala siyang cash, hindi siya liquid, may mga properties naman siya. Ngayon si debtor, ayaw niyang kunin ni creditor yung kanyang mga properties bilang pambayad sa utang niya sa kanya. So, anong gagawin ni debtor? He will defraud the creditor. Anong gagawin niya? Yung mga properties niya, either idodonate niya or ibebenta niya sa ibang tao. Most probably sa relatives niya. Kasi nga, para maprotektahan siya na, sabi niya kay debtor, sabi ni debtor kay creditor, paano, hindi kita mababayaran and wala na rin akong properties na natitira. So, quits na lang tayo, ganun, di ba? Kasi, wala, kasi sa kanya, inisip niya na wala na mabumahabol sa kanya si creditor kasi the ownership of the property is already transferred to other people. Pero sabi ng batas, no. Oo. Action Pauliana can be filed by the creditor in order to protect his right. Oo. Because of the defrauding that was committed by the debtor. So in that case, di ba, sabi natin, debtor transferred his properties to his relatives. Di ba? Ngayon, si creditor, pwede siya mag-file ng action Pauliana to cancel that. Oo, cancel yan. Boom. In order to protect his right against the defrauding committed by the debtor. Yeah? Kasi, kala ni debtor, siya makatakas siya na, hindi na siya pwede habulin ni creditor kasi wala na siyang property na transfer niya sa relatives niya. No. That is an act committed by the debtor to defraud the creditors. Para manggoyo, para manloko, manggancho. Action Pollyanna is there to rectify that. Hmm. Rules on transmissibility of rights and exceptions there too. So generally, all rights acquired in virtue of an obligation can be transmitted. However, the following are the exceptions. Yeah? If the law prohibits transmission, for example, right to partnership, agency, and yung commodatum, ganun. It cannot be transmissible. Hindi siya pwede matransfer. If the parties agree against transmission, oh, pag sabi niya, bawal mo titransfer sa anak mo, okay, goods. And if the right is non-transmissible, for example, the right to vote, non-transmissible. Ngayon, take note, yung utang ba ng anak, ay yung utang ba ng papa or ng magulang, matatransfer ba sa kanyang anak? Hindi. Because, bakit? Anong tutunan niyo sa tax? Anong tutunan sa tax? Na kapag namatay ang isang tao, yung kanyang properties will go to a juridical personality in the form of an estate will be created upon the death of the person to which the properties of that person will be transferred to his estate and the payment of the liabilities of the deceased will be paid out of the estate. So yun nga mapupunta sa anak. Sa estate kukunin yung pambayad ng utang ng namatay na tao. So diba, kung anong matira dyan, then yung magiging mapupunta sa heir based on the distribution of which is based on what the law has provided, particularly the family code. Pag law school kayo nandyan, i-discuss yan sa inyo. Pero sa estate pa yun, basics lang. Diba? Yung utang, yung debt, non-transmissible, hindi mo pwede ipasa sa anak yan. Estate mo kukunin yung pambayad mo. So, punta tayo dito sa primary classification of obligations under the civil code. So, this is under the civil code. So, yun na. Alam nyo, di ba? Familiar to sa inyo. Pure, conditional, obligation the period, alternative, facultative, joint, solidarity, divisible, and obligation the penal clause. So, punta tayo sa pure. Dahil lang si pure, di ba? Puro. Yeah? Kung Tagalog pa yun, puro. Obligations that have no term or condition. These obligations are demandable at once. Of course, with the consideration of dapat reasonable naman. Hindi yung basa-basa lang. Oy, hanggang usapan nyo, sige, bibigay ko sa itong, bibigay ko sa yung kalabaw ko. No conditions, no term. Tapos sabihin ni creditor, sige, ibigay mo lang sa akin ngayon. Pero of course, provide the reasonable time. Yeah, demandable up to once, pero provide reasonable time. Uuwi muna ako para kunin yung kalabaw. Pwede demand ngayon na, di ba? Pure, additional notes lang. Kasi simple lang si pure obligation, puro. Pero kapag lalagyan mo na naman konting churvanes, yeah? Konting additional notes, kumbaga, additional stipulations, yan na. Conditional obligation. Obligations which its demandability or the extinguishment of the obligation, di ba? Kung kailan pwede demand or kailan ma-extinguish, mawawala yung obligation, depends upon the happening of the condition. Kaya nga conditional obligation tawag dyan, obviously. Diba? Kaya nga conditional obligation tawag dyan. Nakadepending demandability, the right to demand by the creditor, or yung pag-extinguish ng obligation mismo, depende upon the happening of a condition. So anong condition? Uncertain event which wields an influence on a legal relationship. Now, take note ang sabi lang, uncertain event. Hindi sinabing uncertain future event. Hindi sinabing uncertain past event. Ibig sabihin, pwedeng past, pwedeng future event yan. Basta ang importante, it is uncertain. And you will see later on sa next slides, sa next slides pa, yung additional notes about event as compared to period. Yan table. So basically, yung conditional obligation, yung extinguishment and demandability ng obligation na kadepende sa happening ng condition. And take note, it does not necessarily mean na kailangan mag-happen yung condition. Nakadepende yan. If it will happen or not, it does not matter. Kasi depende yan sa sa usapan. Pero sa pagdating sa period, yun require yun kailangan mangyari. Pagdating sa condition, hindi. Ito, classification of conditions. Ito, familiar tayo. Suspensive. The happening of the condition gives rise to obligation. resolutory, the happening of the condition extinguishes the obligation. Now, take note there, sa suspensive, the obligation is not yet existing. Okay, take note, not yet existing kasi mag-exist lang yan, it will give rise to obligation kapag nangyari na yung condition. Pero pagdating sa resolutory, the obligation is already existing. Ang inihintay nyo na lang, kailan yan ma-extinguish. Kailan yan ma-extinguish. Anong good example? Yeah? You can use my car. Yeah, sabi ng anak sa tatay, or ng tatay sa anak, you can use my car until you graduate college. Oh, so you can see, you can use my car until you graduate college, until you graduate sa college. That is the agreement. So that is a resolutory condition kasi the father has the obligation to provide the car to the anak. Existing. Na kung saan, ma-extinguish lang yung obligation niya na mag-provide ng kotse sa kanyang anak, magpahiram ng kotse sa kanyang anak, kapag nakagraduate na siya ng college. So, that is the condition. So, upon the happening of the condition, upon makagraduate yung anak, yung obligation ng papa na mag-provide, magpahiram ng kotse sa kanyang anak, is already extinguished. So, that's resolutory. The obligation is already existing. Hinihintay na lang kailan matatapos. So naman, potestative, a condition that depends upon the will of one of the contracting parties, whether on the debtor or on the creditor. Casual are those that depend upon chance or upon the will of a third person. Yeah? And mixed party depend upon the will of the part, one of the parties, and partly upon the will of the third person. So take note, pagdating sa potestative, merong crucial factor dyan. Ito yun. Ito yan. If the condition is potestative upon the part of the debtor, dito tayo merong kailangan tandaan. Potestative, di ba? The happening of the condition depends upon the will of one of the contracting parties. So kapag yung potestative, yung happening of the conditions depends upon the will of the debtor, may kailangan kang tandaan dyan. Ano yun? If the obligation is subject to a suspensive condition, the obligation is void. Bakit? Kasi di ba? Anong suspensive? The happening of the condition gives rise to the obligation. Gives rise to the obligation. So, kapag yung potestative, kapag in this case, di ba? Potestative, the happening of the condition depends upon the will of the debtor. In this case, and the happening of that conditions gives rise to the obligation because it was suspensive. Aba, ano mangyayari dyan? Bakit ma-consider sa void? Kasi isipin mo, di ba ano ang obligation? It is a burden on the debtor. Burden yan sa kanya, pahirap kumbaga. So ang isipin ni debtor, ay, since nakadepende sa akin yung pag-give rise ng obligation, wag ko na lang gawin ang condition. Para hindi ako magkaroon ng obligation to the first place. Di ba? Para siyang loophole. Pero sabi ng batas, bawal yan. It is void. Kasi ang gagawin ni debtor, pag loko-loko yan, hindi niya lang gagawin yung condition. Yeah? Hindi niya lang gagawin yung condition para hindi siya magkaroon ng obligation. So in that case, sabi ng batas, that is void. Oo. In order to prevent that. On the other hand, kapag potestative upon the part of the debtor, meaning, ano ulit, the happening of the condition depends upon him, and the obligation is subject to a resolutory condition, it is valid. It is valid. Bakit? Ano ba ang resolutory obligation, kapatid? The obligation is already existing. Hinihintay niya lang kailan ma-extinguish. O si debtor, may incentive siya para gawin yung condition. Bakit? An obligation is a burden to him. So gusto niyang matapos siya agad. So gagawin niya talaga. Oo, there's an incentive on his part to perform the condition para yung obligation ma-extinguish na because the obligation is a burden to him. Hence, it is considered to be valid because the obligation is already existing. In this case, kasi dito suspensive condition, it will only give rise to obligation. Wala pang obligation. Tapos, isipin mo, yung condition nakadepende kay debtor? Aba, Diyos ko. Yeah? Kaya void yan. Pero on the second part, since that is resolutory, so obligation is already existing and since an obligation is a burden on the debtor, there's an incentive on his part natapo, nagawin na yung condition para yung obligation niya ma-extinguish na. That hence, it is valid. So, yun yung ano. Pagdating naman dito sa ano, potestative upon the will of the creditor, whether or not that's suspensive or resolutory, valid lang. Ang crucial factor lang is pagdating sa debtor, yung potestative. Okay? Take note of that. Take note of that. Lalabas yung supports. Kasi ano yan eh, pang pagulong ng isip yan eh. Yan oh, yung klaseng basic na yan na maggugulo sa isip mo. Lalabas sa support, guarantee. Kasi kahit na basic siya, tricky siya. Yeah? So, punta tayo sa ano, ito. Effect of fulfillment of suspensive condition. As you have said, suspensive condition. Yeah? Suspensive condition. The happening of which gives rise to the obligation. So general rule, the effect of the fulfillment of the suspensive condition gives a retroactive effect, retroactive to the day of the constitution of the obligation. Ano meaning yan? Yeah? Ito yung na-cover natin. Ito yung timeline. Ito yung ano, nagano kayo ng obligation niyo, nagkaroon kayo ng agreement. Ito yung happening of the suspensive condition. So, ang assumption dyan, meron na kayong obligation dito pa lang. O, meron na kayo dito. May usap pa na kayo dito. Hinihintay nyo na lang kailan mag-start. And since nangyari na yung suspensive condition at this part, magkakaroon ng retroactive effect yan na as if yan na talaga yung usapan nyo at the first place. Hinihintay nyo lang yung happening ng condition. O, ganyan yung assumption. Yan, ganyan yung ano dyan. Flow of thought dyan. Ngayon, may exception tayo pagdating sa assumption na yan. In reciprocal obligations, the fruits and interests shall be deemed to have been mutually compensated. Reciprocal, ibig sabihin bilateral, pareho silang may obligation, pareho silang may right. In unilateral obligation, the debtor keeps the fruits and interests received before the fulfillment of the condition. Yeah. Rights of the parties before fulfillment of the condition. Creditor, he may bring the appropriate actions for the preservation of his rights. Ito yun, no? Sanin. Ito yun, no? Ah, hindi. Ito, remedies to enforce preservation of his rights. Debtor, he may recover what he has paid by mistake, solution, debity. So, saan tayo? Effect when debtor voluntarily prevents fulfillment of the condition. Ibig sabihin, yeah? So, debtor voluntarily prevents the fulfillment of the condition. Ibig sabihin, hindi niya nahinayaan, di ba? Pinigilan niya na mismo yung paghapin ng condition. So, anong mangyayari niya? Anong effect niya sa obligation? The condition is deemed fulfilled if the debtor voluntarily prevents the fulfillment of the obligation. Mali wording natin. Dapat condition, no? Voluntarily prevents the fulfillment of the condition to a condition. Mali tayo nang na-type dito. So, the condition is deemed fulfilled if the debtor voluntarily prevents fulfillment of the condition. Of course. Ano, bakit mo? Kasi, di ba? Parang loko-loko si debtor. Bakit may prevent yung, ano, yung fulfillment ng condition? Sabi ng batas, loko-loko ka, ha? So, since ganyan ginagawa mo, gusto mo man loko ng tao, boom. Since you prevent the fulfillment of that, the law will consider that condition to be fulfilled. Oh, huwag ka man loko. Huwag ka man loko-loko. Therefore, the obligation becomes immediately demandable. There must be intent by the debtor to prevent the compliance of the with the condition. Yeah? Kasi loko-loko eh. Bakit may pre-prevent yung ano? Bakit may pre-prevent yung happening of the condition? So, with that, sabi ng batas, loko ka. So, yan. Automatic. Condition is deemed fulfilled. Loko-loko ka kasi. Di ba? Ganun. Rules in case of loss, deterioration or improvement of a determinate thing before the fulfillment of the suspensive condition. Ito, additional notes lang. Yeah. If the loss is without the debtor's fault, obligation is ano? Is extinguished. Oh, walang kasalanan eh. Pero if the loss is with the debtor's fault, the debtor is obliged. Kasi nga, oh, bakit mo sabi na, ganyan kasi ganyan yung batas natin eh. Huwag mong parusahan yung taong walang kasalanan. Yeah? Ito, before the fulfillment. So, additional notes ng laws. Ano yung laws? A thing is considered to be lost when it perishes, goes out of commerce, or disappears in such a way that its existence is unknown or that it cannot be recovered. Ito, deterioration of the thing. Ito, deterioration of thing. Yeah. Ito, for loss. Diba? Rules in case of loss. Ito, for loss. Ito, for deterioration. Ito, for improvement. Kasi, di ba? So, kapag nagkaroon ng deterioration, yung sabi, nag-depreciate, nasira, di ba? Nabulok. Ano mangyayari? If the deterioration is without the debtor's fault, the impairment is borne by the, yung bawas ng value niya, di ba? Si creditor. Kasi without the debtor's fault, bakit mapaparusahan? Di ba? Pero kapag yung deterioration, yung pagkabulok, hinayaan, di ba? Nagkaroon negligence. Hinayaan mangyari. It's due to the debtor's fault. The creditor may choose between rescission and damage. Meaning, kakancel niya na lang yung contract. Kasi ba, nabulok naman yung bagay ni chicken, kasalanan mo, debtor. Cancel na lang natin. Or, fulfillment na lang. Sige, gawin mo na lang yan. Pero may damages. Dito tayo sa improvement of the thing. If the improvement is without the debtor's doing, ibig sabihin by nature, by time, di ba? The improvement shall inure to the benefit of the creditor. Pero kapag yung improvement is due to the debtor's expense, meron there's an active participation on his part to improve the thing, then the debtor is only given the usufructory right over the improved thing and its fruits. Yeah? Kapag yung improvement, walang active participation ni debtor, yung benefit kay creditor. Kapag yung improvement is at the debtor's active participation, yeah, at the debtor's expense, ang pwede lang siyang meron dyan is usufruct. Usufruct lang. Anong usufruct? Usufructory right means enjoyment of the thing and its use and its fruits. Enjoyment lang. Right of usage lang yan. Hindi right of ownership. Right of usage lang. Now let's go to this one. Rules in case of fulfillment of resolutory condition. The obligation is... as we have said, resolutory condition, resolutory obligation. Ano meaning yan? The obligation is already existing. Hinihintay na lang kailan ma-extinguish. And ma-extinguish lang yan upon the happening of the condition. So in that case, kapag nangyari yung resolutory condition, the obligation extinguish. The parties are bound to return each other what of them has received. Yung example natin sa kotse. And in case of loss, deterioration, or improvement, the same rules as discussed above shall apply. Ito, same rules. So yan na. Yan yung discussion natin for conditional obligation. Let's go to obligation with a period. Obligation in which their demandability or the extinguishment is subjected to the expiration of a term which must necessarily come. So dito naman sa obligation with a period. Iba naman dito compared sa conditional. Kasi sa conditional, uncertain event ang pinag-usapan doon. Dito sa period, subject to the expiration of the term which must necessarily come. So, obligation with the period, it talks about time, di ba? Time yung deciding factor dito. Time. The expiration of the term which must necessarily, isa pa, which must necessarily come. Yung uncertain event kasi na pinag-uusapan, na-cover ba? Na-cover ko yun dito. Same rule ah. Okay? So, na-cover pala. Balik tayo sa ano. Yung event kasi, yung uncertain event kasi, na pinag-uusapan sa conditional obligation, either mangyayari o hindi. Ito namang period pinag-uusapan dito, it must necessarily come. The period may either be suspensive, ex dii, or resolutory. So yan, sa conditional, meron tayong suspensive and ano, di ba? Suspensive and resolutory. Sa obligation na period, meron din. Di ba? And same yung effect nila. Suspensive obligation na period, di ba? Ex dii, upon the arrival of the period, the obligation rises. It gives rise to the obligation. The obligation rise, parang bumangon yung patay. Ito naman, resolutory period, upon the happening of which, the already existing obligation now extinguishes. Same ano lang. Pero iba lang yung ano nila, factor eh. Sa conditional, uncertain event.
dito period. Yeah? To legal vantage judicial. Ito yung sabi natin, yung sinabi ko kanina na difference ng condition sa period, yeah? As to fulfillment, the event may not happen. Pagdating sa period, mangyayari. But the date is unknown. As to time, refers to future and past event. Period, future event lang. As to influence sa obligation, yeah? It causes the obligation to rise or cease. Oh, yan yung magiging deciding factor kung magkakaroon or kung mag-e-end yung obligation. Pagdating sa period, ang pag-usapan lang yun din is kailan mangyayari. It only fixes the time when the obligation becomes effective or when the obligation extinguishes. Kasi nga, certain na mangyayari. Certainty. Yan yung punto ni period. It will happen. Tanong lang kailan. Ito naman, obligation na period, obligation sa conditional, hindi ka sure kung mangyayari o hindi. As to the will of the debtor, suspensive potestative, bawal yan. A period, pero pagdating sa obligation na period, pwede. But it will be, pupunta kayo sa korte para i-fix yung duration yan. Yeah? Anong example yan? Yeah? Ano yung pagkakalala natin yung sinabi yung I will pay my debt to you when my means provides me so. Yeah? When my means provides me to do so. So that is an obligation with the period. And it is valid. But you will need to go to court to fix the duration para hindi naman maiwan sa ere si creditor na mapapaisip kailan mo kaya ito marireceive niya. So, court, go to court. Additional notes lang natin yun. Obligation which the demandability or the extinguishment is subjected to the expiry of the term which must na- ay, napauli. Ay, ano yun? Ay, na-double yung ano. So, additional notes regarding to presumptions as to who has the benefit of the period. Yung presumption dyan, kung sino yung magbe-benefit sa period, both of the debtor and creditor. So, with that, the debtor cannot be compelled to perform before the arrival of the period, nor the creditor can be compelled to accept before the arrival of the period. No, if the term has not yet expired. If the benefit of the period is for the both of them. Pero, if sinabi sa agreement that the benefit of the period is for the debtor, then he may perform the obligation on or before the lapse of the period. At his option. Choice niya kung gusto niyang i-perform ng maaga. Ngayon, kapag yung benefit of the period is to the creditor, yeah? To the creditor, he can accept the obligation on or before of the lapse of the period at his option. Choice niya rin kung kailan niya i-receive. So, additional notes ulit. Ito, additional notes regarding when the debtor loses the right to make use of the period. Yeah? If it is for his benefit. The right to make use of the period if it is for his benefit. So, ito. Sige sabihin, hindi niya pwedeng gamitin. Ay, next month pa yun eh. Next month pa yun kung kailangan gawin. Hindi. Yeah? Alam, example nun. Mawawalan siya ng karapatan over that period when the debtor becomes insolvent. Unless he gives a guarantee and security. Yeah? Insolvent. Anong meaning ng insolvency? Technical term. Your liability is greater than the amount of your asset. Yeah? The amount of your liability is greater than the amount of your asset. Greater than the amount of your asset. Insolvent yun. So, in that case, wala na kailangan niya nang gawin yung kanyang obligation. Pero, if the debtor is able to provide guarantees or securities, yeah, pang collateral na, uy, babayaran ko to guarantee. Okay, he can still use his right to make use of the period. On the other hand, another one, second, when the debtor fails to give the guarantees is promised, yeah, nagsabi siya, uy, kahit insolvent ako to, may guarantee ako, magbibigay ako ng guarantee. Pero he fails to do so, okay. Hindi na pwede, loses the right na. Pangatlo, when the debtor impairs the guarantees he promised or furnished, okay, impair, loses the right again. When the debtor impairs guarantees and securities by his own acts or by fortuitous event, they disappear unless he will provide another guarantee, yeah, equally satisfactory guarantee and securities. Okay, he can use ulit the right, yeah, parang sunod-sunod lang. Panglima, when the debtor violates any undertaking in consideration of which the creditor agreed to the period, yun, in contravention of tenor, loses the right. When the debtor tries to abscond, anong mina-abscond? Sinubukan niyang tumakas. Oh, okay, he loses the right to the period ulit. So ito mga examples ng instances when the debtor loses the right to make use of the period for his benefit. Yeah? Lakit na rin ito. Palitin natin. So dito na ngayon, sa alternative obligation na tayo. Sa next type of obligation, next kind. Sa alternative obligation, from the word itself, marami mga alternatives, marami, may mga choices ka. So basahin natin. Those were several prestation, yeah? Prestation. These are obligations na kung saan there are several prestations. Ibig sabihin, may mga subject matter, iba't ibang subject matter that are due. That are due. But complete performance of one of them, isa lang, is sufficient to extinguish the obligation. Oh, there are several prestations. There are several, pwede na i-conduct sa obligation. Pero, yung fulfillment of obligation, goods lang kahit isa lang yung gagawin mo sa kanila. Yeah? The right of choice for this obligation is vested. Yeah? The right of choice, si debtor. Sa pwede pumili, di ba? Alternative, maraming options. Maraming options. Pero yung right of choice na sa kanya, pipili sa alin yung gagawin niya dyan. Yeah? Obligation to give the car, obligation to deliver the diamond ring, or obligation to take him to a concert, and mga prestations. To si debtor, since the right of choice na sa kanya, pili lang siya. Bigyan niya yung kotse, bigyan niya yung diamond ring, or i-liver niya sa concert. Pero kapag expressly provided si creditor, yung pipili sa prestations na gusto niya, goods lang, allowable. Ngayon, may limitations tayo on debtor's right to choose. Debtor must perform the prestation completely. Oo. Completely, hindi partial. He cannot compel creditor to receive part of one and part of the other prestation. Yeah? Yung example natin. Hindi pwede, part-part lang na. Ito yung prestation 1, 2, and 3. Part of prestation 1, deliver ko sa'yo. Part of prestation 2, deliver ko sa'yo. Part of prestation 3, deliver ko sa'yo. Hindi yung pwede gawin. He cannot compel the creditor na, part-part lang, ibigay ko sa'yo. Hindi, he cannot compel. Pero of course, kung okay lang kay creditor, okay, allowable. Liberal naman. Liberty to do so naman, provided sa con. They can do that because contracts, as long as it is not contrary to law, morals, good customs, public order, public policy, or mnemonics yun, pang shortcut yan, lamok paps, law, morals, lamok paps, good customs, public order, public policy, may liberality tayo in making contracts. So, he cannot compel, pero pag okay lang kay creditor, goods lang, walang problema dyan. Pero he cannot compel, hindi niya pwede pilitin si creditor. The debtor cannot choose impossible or unlawful prestation. Like, for example, diba? Obligation to deliver the car. Obligation to deliver diamond ring. And obligation to deliver drugs, illegal drugs. May isa tayong unlawful prestation. Hindi niya pwede piliin yon. Hindi niya pwede piliin yon because that is unlawful. Or another prestation. Obligation to deliver the moon to her. Diba? Pang-apat na prestation. Dalawa ng unlawful and impossible yan. Hindi niya pwede gawin yun. Hindi niya pwede piliin yun. So, yung deliver to the car or deliver the car and deliver the diamond ring, yun alam yung pwede niyang piliin. He cannot choose impossible or unlawful prestations. When obligation ceases to be alternative and becomes simple obligation. Diba? Kasi alternative, meron kang several prestations. Now, the moment the debtor communicated his choice to the creditor, it becomes simple obligation kasi isa na lang yung kailangan niyang gawin. When only, magiging simple ulit yan, simple rin yan, when only one of the prestations is practicable. Ano yung una natin kanina? Deliver the car, deliver the diamond ring, and deliver the, deliver. Pumunta sa concert, iliver sa concert. Na-cancel yung concert, nawala yung diamond ring, isa na lang yung prestation na practicable, then that becomes a simple obligation. And third, when creditor who has the right of choice expresses his choice to the, sinabi ng creditor, oh, gusto ko yung ano, diamond ring, deliver mo sa akin. Boom. Pam-alternative naging simple obligation na lang. Kasi isa na lang yung prestation. Ngayon, we're talking about several prestations which could entail there are several things, several objects in that alternative obligation. So there's always the possibility that one of them hindi pwede ma-fulfill, baka nawala. Yeah? Impossibility of service. What are the rules provided by law? Rules in case of loss of things or impossibility of services which are alternative. The object of the obligation. So, di ba? Kasi several prestations, may possibility talaga na one or two or three or all of that, hindi na pwedeng gawin. Now, yung application of law, nakadepende dyan. Nakadepende. Kung sino yung may right to choose. If the right of choice is na kay debtor, ito yung application of law. If the right of choice is na kay creditor, ito yung application of law. Now, we're talking about, dito sa slide na to, if the right of choice is vested to the debtor, so ano mangyayari in case of loss of the thing or impossibility of service? If only one or some are lost through fortuitous event or through debtor's fault, yeah, one or some, ibig sabihin hindi lahat, may natira pa. And even though it is to the debtor's fault, the debtor may still deliver whatever remains. Bakit? The right of choice is vested on him. So kahit na mawala yung iba dyan, whether or not through his fault, it does not matter. Hindi siya mag-incur ng damages. Bakit? Kasi yung right of choice nasa kanya. He will still deliver whatever remains. Yeah? Hindi siya maano ng damages dyan because the right of choice nasa kanya. Basta may matira. Yun yung mahalaga. Basta may matirang prestation na pwedeng gawin. Second bullet point, if all are lost through fortuitous event, ibig sabihin, hindi kasalanan ni debtor, obligation extinguished based on the rule that no person shall be held responsible for fortuitous event. If all are lost through a fortuitous event, burp tayo. The obligation extinguished. This rule applies only if the things lost were, take note, determinate. Bakit? Kasi pag generic yan, pag indeterminate yan, it is replaceable. Parang jowa mo, mapalitan mo lang yan. Take note, dapat determinate. Ngayon, eto na. If all are lost through debtor's fault, kasi dito, 42-7, diba? He is liable for the value of the last thing na nawala, yung last. Diba? Una nawala yung ano concert ticket, kasalanan niya. Second nawala yung diamond ring, kasalanan niya bakit nawala? And last nawala yung kotse. Kasalanan niya bakit nawala? Since last nawala yung kotse. Yun yung dun siya magiging liable. So take note. Yan pag yan yung mangyari kapag yung right of choice na kay debtor. Ito sa first one, it doesn't matter kung kasalanan niya o hindi niya kasalanan bakit nawala. Basta at least may matira. Yun, wala siyang babayaran ng damages. Sa second bullet point, kapag nawala lahat ng prestation, hindi na pwedeng gawin. Through a fortuitous event, obligation extinguished. Third bullet point, kapag lahat nawala because of his fault, yung last thing na nawala, doon siya magiging liable with damages. Kasi kasalanan niya na eh, in that case. Ito na. As I've said, yung determination ng ano na to, ng application ng law in case of law, yung application of law in case of loss, pagdating sa alternative obligation, nakadepende kanino yung right of choice. Napag-usapan natin yung kay debtor. Now, let's go to creditor. If the right of choice is expressly granted to the creditor, yun, mag-iiba ng application of law. Because yung right dito is na kay creditor na. Mag-iiba na yan. Paano? Uy, maki. Ito ha, take note. Mag-iiba talaga yan. If only one or some are lost through a fortuitous event, the debtor shall deliver that which the creditor should choose among the remainder or that which remains if only one subsists. Yeah? But take note, lost through fortuitous event. So, walang kasalanan si debtor dyan. Since wala siyang kasalanan, you can see, walang damages na kailangan bayaran. Kasi nga, fortuitous event yan. Yeah? Oh. Kung ano yung matira, yun yung pipili ni creditor. Second bullet point, if all are lost to a fortuitous event, obligation extinguish. Matik yan. Ito na, pagdating sa third, if only one or some are lost, are lost through debtor's fault, ito na, kasalanan ni debtor, tapos right of choice na kay creditor. Paano yan? Ganito. The creditor may claim any of those that are still subsisting na pwede pang ma-perform. Or the price of those which were lost through the debtor's fault plus damages. So na, nag-iba na, di ba? Kasi dito nasabi natin, if only one or some are lost to fortuitous event or through the debtor's fault, kung ano man matira, yun ang i-deliver ni debtor, kung anong choice niya, without damages. Pero dito, if only one or some are lost through the debtor's fault, ibig sabihin may nawala dyan to the debtor's fault, and the right to choose is na creditor. Yeah? The creditor may claim any of those subsisting, yung pwede pa, o yung price ng nawala through the debtor's fault plus damages. So dito, in this case, magbabayad na ng damages. Bakit? Kasi kasalanan, the right of choice is na kay creditor na. Yeah? And last bullet point, if all are lost through the debtor's fault, the creditor may claim the price of any of the prestations plus damages. So dito, iba rin. Kasi pag nawala through the debtor's fault, kung ano yung last, yun. Doon siya magiging liable si debtor. Pero kapag yung right of choice na kay creditor na, pwede siyang pumili kung alin yung nawala plus damages. Yun yung magiging payment sa kanya. Kaya nakadepende yan sino may right of choice. Now let's go to the facultative. Dito sa facultative, iba naman to siya pagdating kay alternative. Iba naman to siya. Iba to siya. Bakit? Siya balasahin natin. Obligations where only one prestation is due, but the debtor may choose to render another prestation as a substitute. So dito, isang prestation lang na may substitute. Isang prestation lang meron, pero may substitute kang isa. So rules in case of loss of principal thing and due and substitute. Take note ha, the accessory follows the principal, not the other way around. Kapag nawala yung principal, mawala rin si accessory. Pero kapag nawala si principal, pag nawala si accessory, the principal will still be existing. Because si accessory ang nagpa-follow kay principal. The principal is independent. So with that said, before substitution, principal thing, kapag nawala yan, principal to fortuitous event, the obligation is extinguished. If lost due to debtor fault, the debtor shall pay damages. Pero typical lang, di ba? Yung substitute naman, loss of the substitute, whether through a fortuitous event or through the fault of the debtor, imposes no additional obligation on the debtor because it is not yet due. Wala yan eh. Substitute lang yan. So, ang mangyayari lang dyan basically, yung facultative obligation, magiging simple obligation na lang. Na? Walang liability dyan. Walang additional liability dyan si debtor. Yan, kapag before substitution. Ngayon, kapag after substitution na yan, mag-iba ng usapan. Yung principal thing man yan, whether the loss of the principal thing is due to fortuitous event or debtor's fault, no additional obligation because the substitution has already happened. Yung principal mo naging wakebs ka na dyan kasi nagkaroon ng substitution. Yeah? Pinili mo na yung substitute, yung pamalit. So wala na kebs, wala tayong paki dyan kay principal. Ngayon, after substitution, ano magiging effect doon sa naging substitute? Ito na yung magiging primary. Magiging simple obligation na lang siya. If lost to a fortuitous event, obligation extinguished. If lost to debtor's fault, debtor shall pay damages. Yeah? So think out, after substitution and before substitution. Ito yung sinasabi ating difference sa facultative and alternative. Yeah? Alternative, several prestations due, but the fulfillment of one extinguishes the obligation. Kay facultative, isa lang yung prestation mo. Principal obligation is due, isa lang. Ang ano lang nga dyan, mayroon ka lang substitute, pwedeng pamalit. Alternative, if there are void prestations others that are valid may be demanded. Hence the obligation. Yeah, nagri-ring. Hence the obligation remains. Yeah. Pero kapag sa facultative, yung principal obligation is void, matik, wala na. The debtor is not required to give the substitute. Alternative, the right of choice is with the debtor unless delegated to the creditor. Sa facultative, yung right to choose the substitution na kay debtor lang. Hindi, pwede pa sa creditor. Kasi hindi yan alternative eh. Yung choice ni debtor kapag gusto niyang palitan ng substitute. Oo. And lastly, if all the prestations are impossible, that which is possible must be given. If principal obligation is the debtor is not required to give such. Basically, sa alternative obligation, several prestations. Facultative, isa lang ang principal. May substitute lang. Yan, di ba? So, ayan. Medyo naghilamos muna tayo before natin i-continue discussion sa law. Kasi itong, alam naman natin eh, ito kasing discussion sa law, ito talaga yung inherent na eh, pag mag-discuss ng law subjects eh. Oo, pag more than 1 hour na, oo, nakakantok na yan. Kahit yung nag-discuss sa inyo, oo, yung professor, yung teacher, kahit siya, tatama rin yan eh. Yan yung inherent talaga when it comes to discussing law. So, kailangan may rest yan sa gitna. Kasi nakakaantok yan. Oo. Pag more than 1 hour na. So, dito tayo ngayon sa next ano, part ng discussion natin. Next slide, yung joint obligations and solidary obligation respectively. Now, as you can see, 2 slides lang yan dito. Pero kung makita nyo sa discussion sa book, itong joint and solidary obligation, mahabang discussion to siya. Pero since this is only a review, so review lang ang pag-usapan natin. Saan tayo? Obligations where itong joint and solidary obligations, these are obligations when there is concurrence of 2 or more debtors and or 2 or more creditors in one and the same obligation. So basically, either may 2 or more debtors, tapos isang creditor lang, pwede yun. Joint or solidary makakonsider yan siya. Or there's 2 or more creditors, tapos isa lang yung debtor, pwede yun. Kasi nga nakalagay, oh, and or, nakadepende. Basta there's a concurrence of 2 or more debtors and or 2 or more creditors sa isang obligation. Ngayon, take note, it is very crucial to know if it is a joint and if it is, hininaan ko na yung boses ko ngayon kasi 12 p.m. na eh. 12 p.m., 12 a.m. na. So ito, it is very important to know if it is a joint or solidary obligation. O, crucial factor yan kasi iba yung application of law sa kanilang dalawa. So, bakit? Kasi in a joint obligation kasi, each debtor or creditor is indebted or entitled. O, each debtor is indebted. Each creditor is entitled to proportionate part of the debt or credit. Oo, pro rata yan sila. Proportionate part lang. Oo, independent from each other. Yung kanilang rights or duties sa obligation. Pagdating kasi sa solidary obligation, the burden is greater because each debtor is liable for the whole obligation. For the whole obligation, diba? Nalala niya. Recap lang to kasi. For the whole obligation, each creditor is entitled to demand payment of the obligation. Obligations. Of the obligation. So, makikita niyo yun, diba? Kikita niyo. Joint obligation, the debtors are only liable for their portion. Wala na sila kebs kung ano yung liability ng ibang debtor. Kung anong portion lang nila, yun lang yung kanilang liability. Oh, like example, diba, yung isang debtor, naging insolvent. Magiging liable ba yung ibang joint debtors? Hindi. Hindi sila liable dun. Pero pagdating sa solidary obligation, yung isang debtor naging insolvent, aba Diyos ko, yung ibang solidary debtors magiging liable sa portion niya because they are liable for the whole obligation. The burden pagdating sa solidary obligation is greater for them. And in that case, and in that situation, the general rule is if there is concurrence of 2 or more debtors and 2 or more creditors in one and the same obligation, yeah? Kapag ano diyan, ang assumption that is a joint obligation. That is a joint obligation because as you have said, in a solidary obligation, the burden is greater. Oo. Kaya, sabi dito, kapag ano, silent, automatic assume nyo, joint obligation yan. Ngayon, mag-assume ka lang na, or masasabi mo lang, na isa yung solidary obligation, solidary liability, in these three following cases. The obligation expressly state that it is a solidary obligation. The law requires it to be solidarity. Solidary. Solidarity. Solidary lang yan. Solidary. Go to correct. Or solidarity. Eh, solidary na lang para mas madali. And the nature of the obligation requires solidarity. May example niyan. Di ba? Partnership. Listed naman yan sa legal solidarity. Yung mga examples kung saan masasabi mo na solidary obligation yan. Listed naman yun doon. Pero technically, masabi natin na assumption dyan is joint obligation. Magiging solidary lang yan when these three cases happen. Expressly provided, required by law, and required by the nature of the obligation. Because as you have said, solidary liability is very, yung burden niya greater than joint. Additional note. Additional note lang when it comes to solidary obligation because of the burden it has. If one of the co-debtors has become insolvent, they, as we have said, the other co-debtors shall absorb the loss because they are liable for the whole obligation. Solidarity exists although the creditors and debtors may not be bound the same periods and conditions. What matters is their liability for the whole, they're liable for the whole obligation. A solidary creditor cannot assign his right, solidary creditor cannot assign his right to a third person without the consent of other solidary creditors. Bakit? Because, as you can see here, it is not a typical joint obligation na kung saan, kung anong portion mo, yun lang ang sayo. No. Pagdating sa solidary obligation, yung whole na yan, kayo dyan ang bahala. Kayo dyan ang may right. So in that case, hindi mo pwede basta-basta i-assign yung right mo to a third person without the consent of other solidary creditors because kayong lahat are entitled for the whole obligation. Okay? It is not the same as a joint kung saan kanya-kanya kayo. If assignment is without the consent of the co-creditors, the assignment is not valid as to them. Oh, wala sila labot dyan. Hindi, binigay yung consent nila eh. Hence, co-creditors can claim and recover the respective shares from assigning the creditor in case the assignee who collected the debt fails to give them their shares. Oh, yeah. Defenses available to solidary debtors. Those derived from the nature of obligations, suspicion of legality. Basa niya lang. Additional notes na lang kasi ito eh. Ito naman, pagdating sa divisible obligation and indivisible, ang divisible obligation, capable of partial performance, indivisible, not capable. Oh, kailangan buo. Ito naman, obligation na penal clause. This is an obligation that provides for greater liability in case of non-compliance. Because as we have known, penal. Penal. Penal meaning it provides for the punishment. Oo, provides for a punishment. So in this case, it is an obligation na kung saan the non-compliance provides greater liability. A penal clause is attached to the obligation to ensure performance and to provide for liquidated damages, to strengthen the coercive, force of the obligation. Meaning, si debtor mapipilitan o mas magiging mafo-force siya na gawin yung obligation niya kasi nakita niya, uy, may punishment. Ah, wag nga. So, gawin ko lang itong obligation na to. Di ba? Ganun. By a threat of greater responsibility in case in the event of breach. So, kinds of penal clause, legal, provided by law, conventional, provided by the party, subsidiary, only the penalty is enforceable, and joint obligation and penalty are enforceable. So, general rule, penalty takes the place of damage in case of non-compliance. The following are the exceptions where aside from penalty, damages and interest may also be demanded. Oo, pwede mong idagdag. Generally kasi, yung penalty takes place of the damages in case of non-compliance. Oo. Pero may exception sa ida na kung saan, apart from the penalty, pwede kang maningil ng damage and interest. Kailan yan? When stipulated by the parties, when the debtor refuses to pay the penalty, yeah, and when the debtor is guilty of fraud. O, diyan, may kasalanan na. Bad faith na kasi yan eh. Ngayon, kailan? Diba kasi as we have said, penalties can be stipulated by the parties. No, kailan pwedeng bawasan ng korte ang penalty? When the obligation has been complied by the debtor, partial fulfillment. When the obligation is irregularly complied, partial fulfillment. And when the penalty is iniquitous or unconscionable, even there has been no performance. Bakit? Kasi baka sobrang taas ang penalty, di ba? Mas mataas pa sa liability, mas mataas pa sa obligation, yeah? So in that case, pwedeng babae ng korte. Effects of nullity of the principal obligation. Nullity of the principal obligation carries with it the nullity of the penal clause because the penal clause is an accessory obligation only. And as we have said, the accessory follows the principal. Nullity of the penal clause does not carry the nullity of the principal obligation because as we have said ulit, penal clause is only accessory. So with that, yan yung last portion. Modes of extinguishment of obligation na tayo.
So dito tayo ngayon sa mode of extinguishment ng obligation. As you know, extinguishment, ito yung kapag nag-e-end na yung life ng isang obligation. So ito yung mga modes of extinguishment na pwede mangyari para mag-end. Yeah? Para tapusin yung buhay ng isang obligation. Una, payment or performance. Loss of things due, continuation remission of the debt, confusion merger rights, compensation, annulment, annulment decision, fulfillment of resolutory condition, prescription, and other causes. So, ang pag-uusapan natin dito is yung payment, loss of things, continuation, confusion, compensation, and annulment. Kasi ang annulment, ito yung mag-end, di ba? Mag-i-cancel yung obligation, annulment, rescission, ang kahibaan ng parang pareho yung annulment and rescission, di ba? Kung i-consider mo, di ba? Pero in reality, pagka-discuss nyo sa pagdating nyo ng contracts, sa discussion ng contracts, particularly sa defective contracts, yun, iba sa rescissible, sa voidable, void, and sa unenforceable contract, makikita nyo yung difference ni annulment and ni rescission. Pero basically, ano to sila? Si annulment kasi, yung pinupunto niya is as if hindi nangyari yung contract at the first place. As if it never existed. Once the annulment is done, final na siya, ang assumption na dyan is as if the contract to which that was annulled never existed in the first place. You do not recognize its existence. Sa rescission naman, basically what you're doing here is you're canceling the contract. Although the end result is the same, basically, pero yung means nila, yung principles behind them is different. Ito canceled na. Oo. Ma? It existed. Pero since because of some instances na baka hindi nag-agree yung party or may lesion, yeah, it is canceled. Annulment as if it never existed. Pag na-final yung annulment, ang assumption is as if it never existed at the first place. Ito naman, fulfillment of resolutory condition. Diba? Kasi as you know, resolutory obligations where the obligation is existing. Ang hinihintay na lang is the happening of the condition or the arrival of the period para ma-extinguish yung obligation. Diba? Prescription naman, it relates to time na kung saan. Pag nag-prescribe na, dumating na yung tagi to. Ang prescription kasi, ang punto dito is the right of a person arises from the passage of time or the extinguishment of the obligation arrives at the passage of time. Nakadepende sa oras. So, pag example, after 4 years, wala kang ginagawa, prescribe na yung uno mo, obligation. There's a more in-depth discussion to pagdating sa law school and other causes. So, ang pag-usapan lang natin dito is to sila. Itong sila lang. Nag-end na pindutang end. Yun. Pansin nyo, mahina na ang boses ko. Kasi it's 12:34 a.m. na. Tulog na mga tao. So, dito tayo ngayon sa payment of performance. Payment of performance means the delivery of money and performance of the obligation in any manner, in any other manner of an obligation. So, di ba? Kung ano na pag-usapan nyo, na i-deliver mo itong bayad ng utang mo, yeah, performance obligation, services, delivery of goods and services. Basta kung ano na pag-usapan nyo, tinupad mo kung ano yung pinag-usapan nyo. Yung obligation mo sa inyong, ano, sa yung debtor or creditor. So, legal tender, when it comes to money, additional na itong legal tender, as you know, legal tender in the Philippines is the Philippine peso. And legal tender is the money or currency which the debtor may compel his creditor to accept in payment of his debt, whether that debt is public or private. Ngayon, ang legal tender sa Philippines, gaya na sabi natin, is Philippine peso. Now, ang tanong, can you pay your creditor in dollars? Yes, you can, if the creditor will accept that. But take note, you cannot compel your creditor to accept the US dollars. Kasi kung isipin mo, wala, hassle, additional hassle yan kay creditor kasi pupunta pa sa money exchange para papalitan lang yan to Philippine peso. Hence, sabi dito, legal tender, Philippine peso. Now, additional notes regarding the special forms of payment, dasyon in payment, or as we know, dasyon in pago, application of payment, payment by cession, and tender of payment and consignation. Ngayon, itong dasyon in payment or dasyon in pago. It refers to the transfer of ownership of property to the creditor as a form of payment of the debt which was supposed to be made in money. Meaning, for example, may utang kasi isang tao of 1 million peso, problema, wala kang cash. So, nasabi na lang, nag-agree na lang kayo, ito na lang, ano ko, ito na lang kotse kong ipambayad ko sa utang ko sa'yo. Okay, good, so lang problema, dasyon in pago. Transfer of ownership na lang yung ipapambayad mo. And dasyon in pago is governed by the rules of on loan sales. Application of payment, dito naman, refers to the designation of the debt to which payment shall be applied when the debtor owes several debts in favor of the same creditor. So, same isang debtor, isang creditor, si debtor, maraming utang kay creditor. Ngayon, itong application of payment, it provides for the rule na since there's multiplicity of obligations, siyempre, para mas mamadalian, meron tayong ano, paano yung bayaran. No? Sino, aling obligation na mauna babayaran. Diba? Parang ganun. Now, take note, pagdating sa rule na to, ang mananaig is kung ano yung napag-usapan ni debtor and creditor kung alin yung utang na unang babayaran. O, kasi yun, liga, diba? Making contracts is ano, very liberal as long as basically you do not make labag on lamok paps, law, morals, good customs, public order, public policy, you're good. You're good. Ngayon, if there's no stipulation or agreement between the creditor and the debtor when it comes to the application of payments, kung alin utang yung unang babayaran, then ang usapan, ang sabi na batas, mauna yung most onerous. Okay? Payment by cession. Ito naman sa payment by cession, take note, it is different from dasyon and pago. Bakit? Kasi si payment by cession refers to the debtor's abandonment or assignment of all of his property to the creditor's payor so that the creditor may sell them and apply the proceeds of his claim. Dito sa dasyon and pago kasi, there's transfer of ownership ng property. And upon such transfer, kahit na iba yung value ng ownership doon sa amount ng utang, automatic extinguishment obligation. Pagdating sa payment by cession, ang ibinibigay lang na right ni debtor kay creditor is yung the right to sell the property and kung saan yung proceeds from that property will be applied to the utang of the debtor. Na in that case, kapag nagkulang pa rin yung amount ng nabenta, hindi sapat para mabayaran yung utang, walang choice yan, no? Si debtor, but dagdagan yan. Oo, ganun. Sa dasyon ng pago kasi, no matter how much the value of the property is, automatic extinguishment obligation. No matter how different. Kasi yung assumption eh. Transfer of ownership. Pa-payment by cession, yung proceeds lang, it will be applied. Kung may sobra man, edi punta kay debtor yan. Pero pag kulang man, kailangan pa yung dagdagan, magabono pa ng additional si debtor. Kasi nga, ang nangyari lang dyan is assignment of properties. Kung saan, ang right lang na pinasa dyan ni debtor is the right to sell that. And to get the proceeds from the sale. Ngayon dito tayo sa tender of payment and consignation. Itong tender of payment, parang inabot mo yung pambayad mo. It is the act of the debtor offering to his creditor what is due to him. Yun si tender payment. Inalok mo, hoy, creditor, itong pambayad ko sa utang ko sa'yo. Simple. On the other hand, ano itong consignation? It involves the court na basically, kapatid. Consignation is the act of depositing the sum or thing due with the judicial authorities whenever the creditor refuses without just cause to accept the thing due or in cases when the debtor cannot accept it. For example, di ba? Gusto mo nang bayaran yung utang. Ayaw mo nang ma-burden. O ayaw mo nang obligation. Ialok mo na kay creditor.
time na para magbadang utang. Kaso si creditor ayaw tanggapin without no without justifiable reason. So in that case, kawawa si debtor dito kasi may obligation pa siya, may burden pa siya eh. Kung tinanggap lang ni debt ni creditor yung tender payment na, wala na siyang burden. Eh kaso matigas ulo ni creditor without justifiable cause. So si debtor, remedy niya, punta sa court, i-deposit niya doon yung claim, i-deposit niya doon yung thing due or the sum. And with that, pag proper proceedings ano, proper proceedings sa BAPEN, the court allowed such deposit, automatic magdi-declare ng court na extinguish na yung obligation ni debtor. Oh, based on the facts and circumstances of the case, remedy yan ni debtor para sa isang creditor or against sa isang creditor na matigas ang ulo, ayaw tanggapin yung kanyang bayad without any justifiable reason. Okay? Let's go to the loss of the thing due. Itong loss of the thing due, ilang beses ito na natin na-mention, di ba? So, of course, when the thing perishes or goes, di ba? Na-discuss, nasabi naman natin kanina kung ano yung definition ng loss, di ba? Loss is when it occurs when the thing perishes or goes out of commerce or disappears in such a way that its existence is unknown or cannot be recovered. The loss includes legal and physical impossibility of the service in which the obligation consists. Like, for example, di ba? For example, legal or physical impossibility. Physical impossibility. Ano? Tumakbo ka ng 1,000 kilometers per hour. O, di ba may tumakbo 1,000 kilometers per hour? That's physically impossible. Legally impossible. For example, ang utos ay parang ganito. Nung January, nag-avail ka ng services para i-massage ka by February. Hypothetical lang to, pero by February, nagkaroon ng batas, before mag-arrive yung date ng schedule mo, nagkaroon ng batas na kung saan ginawa ng illegal yung pagmamasahe. Na in that case, the obligation or the thing due, the thing to be done, is already lost because it became legally impossible. Kasi pinagbawalan ng batas. Although physically possible siya, it is legally impossible kasi pinagbawal ng batas. Hypothetical lang naman. Additional note tayo on the loss of generic thing. Diba? As you have said, the loss of the generic thing generally will not extinguish the obligation. Bakit? Genus non comperit. Something that's generic never perishes. Parang ganun yung pagkakalala ko dito. It never perishes. Something that is generic never perishes. However, nakita niyo yung word na generally. So, ano meaning yan? Ibig sabihin may exception. An exception to this rule is in the case of delimited generic thing. Ano meaning delimited? Basically, it is generic. Pero yung population ng generic thing is already, nababawasan na. Kukunti na lang sila. Although generic siya, pero yung population niya, nababawasan na. So parang pinapakita nun, nagiging limited na siya. And nagiging limited na siya, parang nagiging specific na siya. Yeah, parang ganun. So yun yung exception. Yung delimited generic thing, yung population ng generic thing na yan, o yung population nila yan, nababawasan. Konti na lang. Ngayon, additional note on the loss in personal obligation. To personal obligation to do. So, when the prestations become legally or physically impossible without the debtor's fault, the obligation extinguished. For example, yung masahe-masahe example. Ngayon, if the service has become so difficult as to be manifestly beyond the contemplation of the parties, the obligor may be released in whole or in part. Ito naman, additional note on the effect of loss of determinate thing. General rule natin, the loss of a determinate thing, specific thing, extinguishes the obligation because it is specific, it is determinate, it cannot be replaced as compared to generic. Yeah? Pero, general yan, general rule, may exception. When the loss is due to debtor's fault, kasalanan ng debtor, nawala. Okay. Hindi siya excusable. When the debtor has incurred delay, na tandaan nyo, dapat nauna yung delay. Delay should be the precedent. Hindi siya antecedent. Delay should be the precedent before the happening of the loss. So dapat delay, loss. When so provided by law, as when the debtor promised to deliver the same thing, ito ang sabi natin kanina, to two or more persons who do not have the same interest. Bakit? Kasi there's a fault on the debtor's part. When stipulated, may bad faith sa kanya. Bibenta mo sa dalawang tao yung specific thing. Puso nga, hindi pwede sa dalawa.
specific thing pa kaya? When stipulated by the parties, agreement nila, liberality of contracts. When the nature of obligation requires the assumption of risk, insurance. When debt proceeds from criminal offense, unless the person who should have received it refuses to accept it without just cause. Ato, puto tayo sa next extinguishment debt, modes of extinguishment. Condonation or remission. Basically, without reading that, condonation is remission is pinatawad mo yung utang ng debtor. You're the creditor, pinatawad mo yung utang niya sa'yo. Bait mo. Grabe. Refers to the creditor's abandonment of by the creditor of his right. Oh my God, mag-blackout. Oh, biglang umina yung kuryente. Shit. Refers to the gratuitous abandonment by the creditor of his right. It also refers to the forgiveness of the debtor's indebtedness. Oh, mabait ka. In order to extinguish the obligation, the condonation or remission must also be done with the debtor's consent. Hala sir, bakit kailangan ng debtor's consent? Anong reason? Basically, kasi nagbumukha tong donation. Or donation talaga to. And nagkakaroon lang ng valid donation kapag merong consent. Merong acceptance on the part of the donee. In this case, the debtor. Yeah? Kaya na kailangan ng debtor's consent dito para maging valid yung condonation remission. Now, there are two forms expressed like in writing orally. Real property executed in public instrument, personal movable, about 5K, executed in public instrument, 5K. Below any form, inferred by the acts parties yung implied. Now, let's go to confusion or merger. Ano tong confusion or merger? Yung merger, di ba may pinatay ka niya? Joke lang. Occurs when there's meeting in one person of the qualities or character or characters of creditor and debtor. Huh? Meaning in one party, the characters of debtors and creditor. Simple lang yan. Ito yung ginamit ko yung example dun sa in-depth discussion ko sa mga bata. Ikaw si A, may utang sa'yo si, may utang ka kay B. Yeah, may utang kay B. Itong si B, may utang kay C. Itong si C, may utang kay D. Si D, may utang kay F. And si F, may utang kay I. Na kung saan, si I, may utang kay A. So, in that case, ano mangyayari? Extinguish na yung obligation. Because, of course, when there's meeting one person, the qualities of the characters of creditor and debtor. Parang ganyan. That is a simple illustration. So, in this case, si A may utang kay B, si B may utang kay C, D, F, and I. Oh, you know, hindi ko nalagay si E, pero this point still stands. So, si A, naging debtor siya and creditor ng kanyang sarili. Ngayon, that is a simple illustration. Ano ang realistic illustration niya, sir? When it comes to negotiable instrument, yung endorsement, yeah? Si A nag-ano ng order instrument kay B. Tapos in-endorse ni B kay C, D, F, and I, tapos bumalik kay A. Oh, yun, endorsement. So, extinguish ang obligation. Because the character of the creditor and the debtor napunta sa isang tao na. Yun, di ba? Simple illustration, may utang si ABC. Realistic illustration, endorsement of negotiable instrument. So, additional notes on merger in a joint obligation. Merger extinguishes only the share of the joint debtors or creditor in whom the character of debtor and creditor concur. Kasi as we know, joint obligation, kung ano lang yung share mo, yun lang yung may pake ka. Oo, independent yan sila. Pero pagdating sa solidary obligation, the merger in one of the, the merger in one of the solidary debtors or solidary creditors extinguishes the whole obligation. Obviously, bakit? Anong sabi natin solidary obligation? Debtor, all the debtors, liable for the whole obligation. Creditors, solidary creditors, entitled for the entire obligation. In that case, the solidary debtor in whom the characters of the debtor and creditor concur can demand reimbursement from his co-debtors. Kasi because of that, na-extinguish yung whole obligation. So, pwede siya mag-demand ng reimbursement from the other solidary debtors. Yeah? Ito naman si solidary creditor shall be also liable to his solidary creditors for the share corresponding to each of them. Because na-extinguish yung obligation because of his confusion or merger on his part,
So since ganun nangyari, kasi isipin mo lang, na-receive yung solidarity creditors eh. Wala silang na-receive because of that confusion or merger. So pwede nilang bawiin yun kay solidarity creditor na naging responsible sa confusion or merger. Same thing dito solidarity debtor. Kasi di ba? Dahil sa kanya, na-extinguish yung obligation, confusion or merger on his part, na yung other solidarity debtors, wala silang ginawa. Nag-benefit sila. And as we know, unjustly enrichment shall not be allowed at the expense of another person. So, yung other co-debtors niya, mag-reimburse sa kanya. Yeah? Yeah, ganun. Simple lang. And compensation. Itong compensation, mode of extinguishing an obligation when two persons in their own rights are debtors and creditors of each other. Yeah? Si A may utang kay B. Si B naman may utang kay A. Ganun kasimple. So, requisites that each of the obligors be bound principally and that he be at the same time as the principal creditor of the other. So, dapat quit sila bilateral. However, a guarantor may set up a compensation as regards what the creditor may owe the principal debtor pa rin. So, both debts consist in a sum of money or if the things you are consumable, they be of the same kind and also of the same quality. The latter has been stated. Dapat pareho yung nature ng obligation. And take note that the debts are due. That both the debts be liquidated, determinable, and demandable, enforceable. That over neither of them there be any retention or controversy commenced by third persons communicated in due time to the debtor. So take note, kahit na may mga requisites dito na hindi na, no? Kasi ito, automatic compensation to eh. Na automatic, pag nangyari yan, may compensation na. Pero meron rin tayong contractual compensation na kung saan kahit na, example, yung utang ni AKB, January 15 pa yung January 15 yung due. Yung utang ni B kay A is January 30 pa. So kahit na both debts have different due dates, pwede sila mag-agree. Liberality of contracts, liberality of agreements na, okay, equits na lang natin, compensation na lang tayo. Oo. Ito kasi pinapakita yung automatic o by operation of law, may compensation. Pwede rin mag-agree yung mga parties on their own, magkaroon ng compensation on their part. Contractual yun. Pwede yung mangyari. Kahit na, di ba? Yung example, January 15, January 30, so different due dates, yung debts. Pero pwede sila mag-agree na i-disregard na lang yun para mag-compensation na sila on their own. Okay? So, dito tayo sa last part, novation. Itong sa novation, the modification, extinguishment of an obligation by another, either by changing the object or principal condition, substituting the person of the debtor or subrogating a third person in the rights of the creditor. So, basically, nagkaroon dito ng yung may dalawang obligation dito, yung old pati new. Yung old obligation, mayroong mga significant changes yan. Yeah? May mga changes yan na kung saan it resulted to the birth of the new obligation. Ito yung mga either by changing the object or principal condition. Like for example, instead of paying a car or delivering a car, bigay ka na lang ng pera. Yun. Changing the object or principal condition. Substituting the person of the debtor. Iba na yung bagong debtor. Oo, transfer yung obligation or yung duties or subrogating a third person in the rights of the creditor. Transfer. Yeah. Simple lang, diba? Old obligation, may new. Ganyan lang yan, sinovation. And yung mga reason bakit nagkaroon changes, ito. Take note, ito yung mga dapat reason. Tatlo yan sila. If new obligation is void, the novation is void. Yeah? Kasi baka yung new obligation, ang ginawang object is the delivery of illegal drugs. So yun, new obligation is void yun. So novation is void. The original obligation, yeah, yung previous one, yung old one, shall subsist unless the parties intended that the former relation will be extinguished in any event. If the original obligation is void, yeah, yung original obligation, yung old obligation, delivery of illegal drugs, nagkaroon ng novation. Wala lang, novation is void pa rin kasi yung source niya is void. Yung source niya is void. So take note of that. So yan lang yung discussion natin. Ay, meron pa pala. Last ano pa pala. So itong requisites for novation, kapatid. So there is a previous valid obligation. There is an agreement of the parties to modify or extinguish the obligation. O dapat valid sila. Previous valid.
para hindi maging void. So there's an agreement of the parties to modify or extinguish the obligation except in the following circumstances. Oh, modify, extinguish the obligation. When the person debtor has changed, which can be made against the will debtor. When the other person obligated in place under the following instances. Okay. Pang-apat na requisites, there must be extinguishment of the old obligation. Kaya nga, novation, kailangan palitan yung bago. So, iwanan mo ng ex, iwanan mo ng shota mo ngayon, punta ka sa bagong nililigaw mo. And there must be validity of the new obligation. So, dapat maging valid din yan para maging valid yung novation nyo. So, yun yung requisites. So, yan yung extinguishment ng modes of extinguishment ng obligation na madiscuss. And that is the end of the review. Tatandaan nyo, review to ah. Review lang to. Kung gusto nyo ng in-depth, then punta kayo doon sa videos ko sa in-depth. Pero ito, for review purposes lang on the obligation portion of the subject, loan obligations and contracts. Yung contracts, posted naman yun. Yun yung gagamitin natin kasi nagawa naman yun ng video. Same lang yung discussion. So with that, bye-bye. Love you. Punta ka na sa contracts.